meeting of the Board of Selectmen to order. I'll first go over our agenda for tonight. We'll first have our customary reports and comments. First, the Selectmen's liaison reports, then public comment, and then the town manager's report. Then we're going to have, what is always one of my favorite activities, police and fire badge pinnings at 7:15. At 7:30, we will receive a town accountant quarterly update, quarterly report, including an update on the school revolving funds. And at 8 o'clock, a hearing for an early opening request for Tread LLC at 6 Linden Avenue. We have a slight change to the remainder of the schedule. We will be deferring our meeting with the Climate Committee. They will not be in tonight at 8:30. Instead, we're going to move the Board of Cemetery Trustees portion of the meeting to 8:30 and the preview of the financial form to approximately 9 p.m. So with that, I'll call on the board for liaison reports. I'll start on my right, Mr. Arena.
Nothing to report, but I did want to welcome back Selectman Halsey from his recuperation. We've missed you. It's been a lot shorter meeting and a lot less.
I knew you couldn't let it go, Jeff.
But more serious notes, glad to see you back.
Thank you.
That's it.
Mr. Halsey, I will add my welcome.
It is good to be back, for sure. And I actually have, you know, some other remarks that, you know, as we get ready to do the pinning tonight that I'd like to reserve the right to come up with. But as I'm kind of just back in action, I haven't been around to my usual haunts. However, last night I visited the ARCASA presentation, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that, although Barry was there with me as well, and I'm sure he's going to have some thoughts about it. I found that I think we're now 10 years downstream with ARCASA. We've got information dating back to 2005 through 2015. And Erica McNamara did a spectacular job covering an awful lot of ground in a, you know, stuff that probably should have taken 3 hours. She got in about 45 minutes or so. And there were parts of it that were encouraging to me. The fact that we have the knowledge we have now is one of the most encouraging things to me, because we have such a better understanding of what's going on in our town surrounding these issues than we ever could have possibly had 10 years ago. And we're making some very positive strides forward. I think everybody would agree that if we found a way to eradicate substance abuse in this town, it would be cause for, you know, great celebration. That's not going to happen overnight, but there's definitely progress that's been made. Part of my other takeaway is that ARCASA has found its way to expand our knowledge base in related topics like bullying, like violence, like sexual issues that our young people are facing. And I think all of this, that report, as I said, I think everybody probably had 100 questions for her, and you know, you can't totally monopolize it, but I just want to compliment Erica and her team and their coordination and cooperation with the police department, with Jim's leadership there. We're making enormous strides, a lot of work left to do. I would heartily encourage that. I think I'm going to have the PowerPoint sent to me and then give it to Bob, and that can be circulated so that you can get a sense of the meeting.
Right. Appreciate that.
But the other thing that I did, what that wasn't exactly a liaison, but I think it's something that we're all going to be interested in. Reading is part of a coalition of 20 communities that makes up the Regional Emergency Planning Committee. I know we've kind of heard about that, you know, more anecdotally than not. I was able to attend their semi-annual meeting this morning. I happened to be there with Chief Cormier and Chief Burns, and head of the DPW, Deputy Chief Mark Sagala was there. And I just have to tell you, we all, you know, in town probably sleep a lot better, not knowing why, but knowing that we've got a team of people that are actually looking out for us and preparing in advance for us. The content of the meeting was like 4 hours, so I'm not going to get into this particular content, but I think it's important to remind our citizens and each other that there's so much going on behind the scenes with the teams from public safety and DPW and the staff that are busy planning for us, busy making sure that if something goes wrong, they not only know what to do, they know when to do it, and they know, and they've partnered in a very strategic way with all of our neighbors, so that if something happens in one community, we can rise to the occasion to help them, and they can rise to the occasion to help us. And I think that we probably sometimes don't realize the scope and hard work that goes on behind the scenes on behalf of all of us. So that was the Mystic Regional Emergency Planning Committee. 20 communities, isn't that right, Jim? Yeah. So, and that's it for now for me.
Thank you, John. Welcome again. Gary.
Welcome back.
Thanks.
Of course, the first time I see you was at another one of these meetings. when I was at, I was with you at the school committee meeting last night where Ricasa presented the risk behavior survey for the high school. And I have to agree that one of the things that it's great to have is the data. And not just the data in any one particular year, but now we have data that goes back now 7-8 years. And we can see the strides that we made and some of the setbacks that we have, and then some of the new problems that we never even envisioned. So, you know, I looked at it, you know, not only because I have a high school son in that age group, but also in terms of, I was thinking about it in terms of, well, what are some of these trends? What are some of the things that town government can actually do? Some of it may not be a lot, but some of it may be. It may be, you know, a position here or there to do something. So I was looking at it in terms of from a public policy standpoint, like, you know, what can we do on the, you know, on the board and also with the school committee to sort of address some of these things. I mean, the good news is we made a lot of strides. There's some things, you know, use of tobacco, for example. Binge drinking is down. There's certain things that you can actually point to, and you can actually even say why we, you know, the interventions that we did over the last few years can actually lead to that. But then there's also some things that we slid back on. So that was an interesting meeting. I'm really looking forward to getting the stuff from the middle school. Because I'm actually not looking forward to it. I think that's going to be even more scary. I mean, we have to intervene at such a younger age right now on a lot of these behaviors. And, you know, that data wasn't available. It will be soon. And I think that, you know, it'll be also enlightening. In addition to that, I attend actually with Kevin attended the hearing that the Historic District Committee did on Summer Ave. There was about 100 neighbors there voicing various opinions about the project that Criterion, as we know, is proposing. They came back with a total remodel of the initial proposal. It was anticipated that the Historic District Committee would make a decision. That decision has actually been put back, I think, another week or two. Just, you know, waiting to hear that. So I attended that. And then also, lastly, what I'd like to do is kind of a little bit of a personal plug, although not necessarily for me, but for my better half. My wife, Laura, is, along with Mary Ann Downey, is chairing the Reading effort around the Enough Abuse campaign. Which is basically a campaign that's sponsored for Mass Citizens for Children to educate community leaders on trying to end child sexual abuse. They're going to be hosting a meeting in November in which we are all going to be invited to, along with the school committee and other neighborhood and community leaders. Again, you know, we live in a town that has community activists in it, you know, working really hard to address some of the things that, you know, that we really need to take a look at. So,
Gary, can we have the name one more time?
Yep. It's called the Enough Abuse Campaign. It's sponsored by Mass Citizens for Children and a couple of other sort of statewide coalition of other groups advocating for children. It involves I think is a member of the police department that's involved in it, and also a lot of the different organizations here. And, and basically the meeting in November is going to be sort of, you know, sort of training us as community people, things to look for, things that we can do. So as selectmen, we're going to be invited to that, and something that we should look forward to going to.
Do you have the date again? You don't know yet?
You know what? It's November. Laura's going to kill me.
It's next month, though.
It's in November, and I'll make sure I get it out to folks. So I apologize for that.
And like Barry said, we attended the forum last week for the Summer Ave property. And just to add on to what Barry had said, their next meeting, I believe, is going to be this Thursday night, and they have a following Thursday night, I believe, or a following night next week. So they have two more meetings scheduled for that proposal. Also, I was with John last night, John Halsey, for our what we feel is our final fire on ad hoc committee meeting. This was basically a meeting where we were just there to vote on all of the minutes from our previous meeting. So as you all know, we have the Warren article going on for November town meeting and guards that came out of that committee. And then on a fun note as well, I remembered seeing an email come across our desk about it, but then as I drove past it with my daughter and her friend, and we see every fire apparatus that we own out on Main Street this past weekend, said, "Oh, Daddy, can we go see that?" I said, "Okay." So I said, "That's right. I'd forgotten about that." So I actually kind of lucked into that one, which was a fun event to go. They had their open house. I think they do it annually.
Yes.
Had a great demonstration that they did that acted both as a phenomenal demonstration for the kids, where they essentially ripped the roof off of a car in the front doors to show how they use their jaws of life and, for lack of a better term, their power scissors that just cut through these door frames like it was nothing. And it was great because the kids obviously loved it. You know, it was phenomenal. They get to climb on all the vehicles. They see these, you know, car roof being flipped back open. And for the firefighters, you know, I'm sitting there going, wow, what a great opportunity to have a good training exercise. As well, and do it out in the public display.
Recruiting, even.
Yeah. So that was fun to kind of luck into.
It won't be the last one you go to, by the way. How old's your daughter?
She's only six. That's going to be a yearly thing for us, and especially when they have, you know, donuts and pizza out there for the kids too.
Your son hasn't even figured this out yet.
So we got a good 18, 20 years of going to that, which will be fun.
Very good.
That's all I have.
Thanks, Kevin.
Okay, Barry and I attended, and I don't know if anyone else was there, the October 7th meeting. The MAPC held another little round robin forum at the RMLD. They've advanced their designs a little more. They were still soliciting inputs from the public, and I believe they will be appearing before this board with a final report, Bob, sometime
December 1st.
So they were still somewhat in information gathering mode, but you could tell they had progressed slightly more along the path of getting these four areas to fruition. Again, it's going to take a lot of follow-up by the Public Services Department and all of us to bring those plans to fruition. On the 13th, I had two events, October 13th. There's a new show out called Reading Conversations. Kevin Vent hosts it, and I think a couple of us have gotten nailed to be on that show already. I think, Barry, you were already tapped. They taped a 13-minute segment just asking me about current issues on the selectmen, so I obliged. I'm not sure when that's going to air, but I think they're going to bag all of you sooner or later, so get ready.
On the YouTube account, it just shows up.
Yeah, it just shows up. Also, attended the second meeting of the Permanent Building Committee on the 13th. The center event discussed that evening was the cemetery garage. I think some good progress was made, and we're going to continue those discussions this evening when the Board of Cemetery Trustees are in. Another thing I did, sort of getting prepared for our final agenda item on the financial forum, I took out the speech I gave to town meeting back in April of this year, in which I foreshadowed some looming financial issues that we were going to have to take a stand on at some point. And I want to quote, I'm not going to read too much of this, but in part I said, "The town and school budgets in FY16 are able to maintain core services, but not quite level services in the face of increasing demands.
The use of several one-time sources of funding, grants on the town side and both grants, and a heavier use of offsetting revolving funds on the school side allow for the core services in FY16 to be protected for one more year. However, faced with the same revenues and accommodated costs in FY17, it appears that each side will need to make reductions to these core services a year from now unless other cost savings or sources of income are found. Reading should be proud of how the town and schools work together and spend efficiently. The Board of Selectmen and School Committee are the town's two chief policy-setting boards. It is my goal as chairman in 2015 to work across the aisle with the school committee to explore all possible economies of scale in combining our operations as a prelude to the FY17 budget planning season. It is important that a good measure of progress be made in achieving such cost reductions before any measures such as operational override are considered by the town. This will be an open and transparent process with ample opportunity for all stakeholders to comment. And then the chair of the school committee got up and added his assent to that process. I'm happy to report that some progress, significant process was made this year in the area of facilities management. I think we've talked about that in previous meetings where we essentially now have three areas of you know, there's like a common accommodated cost area, facilities, and then separate town and school areas. We have collaborated much more on hiring of technology support on the school side. Kevin Ferrillo was very instrumental there, and we're making good inroads on the HR process. So with all that in mind and looking ahead, I think it is very important that we take the first steps tonight to talking about addressing the revenue service imbalance in coming years, and we're going to start to get into the area of discussing an operational override. We don't know when that should happen yet. There's a lot of discussion at our financial forum that will have to happen first, but this is the time this evening when I think this board should start that discussion. Now, where it ends, we don't know. There's a lot of things to be considered. John?
Yeah, obviously we're beyond the liaison discussion. I really value your remarks, Dan, and I honestly think that this is not an easy topic to be considering, and I think all of us, I'm glad that our chairman has decided to put this on the table for us all to talk about. I think each of us in our own way is probably sat with the town manager and had discussions on pieces of this. When you start putting all the pieces together, you start to realize, at least from my perspective, you start to realize that you study Prop 2.5 and you study a budget and you study the way that we provide services in this town, and you have the opportunity to visit with citizens of this town and understand their wants and needs from their town. And you can only come, in my opinion, to a conclusion that is a difficult one for me to actually even put on the table, but one that I think is really important. I tend to think that one of the things we have to do is safeguard the money that the citizens put in our hands. Those are tax dollars, and they should be spent wisely and always in a value proposition. But I do think we are at a crossover place when you examine how Prop 2.5 works. There have been operational overrides that have happened twice in this town. They happened pretty much a decade or so apart.
Approximately.
I think tremendous, you know, management, frankly, and highly committed employees both in the school and the town have allowed us to find ourselves now 13 or 14 years after the last operational override, and probably looking down the barrel of what's going to happen if we don't create more revenue in this town. My opinion is, I've done some work with the Human Resources Department here in town. I've had many discussions with people in the schools, and frankly, we've got issues like employee retention that are going to be looming if we don't address the issue of proper, you know, salary. We've got a lot of, you know, lifelong employees who will be retiring over the course of the next handful of years. And frankly, my own experience in working with human resources here is that we're going to have a hard time hiring capable people unless we've got the operating revenue to work with. The demands for services are another thing that are very real here. We have a population, the MAPC that you mentioned, Dan. They've given us, I believe there's a certain reliability to everything that they told us. Who knows, when you forecast, it's not an exact science, but they're telling us that our population in Reading is going to, our aging population is going to be the most substantially growing population. Could be in 30 years 70% larger than it is today. And along with aging citizens, we have service requirements. We can't back away from those. So I guess I don't mean to turn this into, I guess I have turned it into a speech. If we're going to manage the quality of education and who we have delivering services from the standpoint of staff, and we understand that we're facing continuous unfunded mandates that come out of Beacon Hill, we've got to take care of ourselves. And so I'm sitting here endorsing the discussion that you're talking about, Dan.
Thank you.
It's my opinion that the selectmen, the five of us were elected by the citizens of this town to look after their best interest. And I think one of the things that we have to do is look at the revenue streams. Let's understand, let's make them go as far as they can, but let's understand that in the best interest of good schools and good services, and everybody likes the continuing asset values that are building in their homes, we're going to need to do some things, and I think we need to explore every possibility. And we need to do it aggressively as a group of five of the community leaders, and take the lead here to see what and how we should do this, and start a process of informing our citizens about what the future looks like. So,
thank you, John. Yeah. Let's be brief and go ahead.
Just to amplify John's point, I think that also makes it incumbent for us to explain to Mr. and Mrs. Town of Reading the thought process. We've got access to the finances and the forecasting that the average citizen at home may pick a bit of it up now and then in a meeting. It's up to us then to make clear the future as it's in the near term been portrayed, the trajectory we're on, so that everyone understands the lay of the land. And it doesn't sound like we've all changed our mind, but that they understand the basis on which we're deciding.
To be continued. Thanks. Okay. Bob, I'm sorry, is there any public input on any topic not on the agenda tonight? Okay, Bob, do you have a
brief report? I'll be real quick. Okay. On page 2 of your packet tonight, there's an invitation from our Veterans Service Officer for Veterans Day, November 11th.
Oh, good.
Have a look at that and let us know. That'd be great. Okay. I also agree, I just want to make a brief comment. I was one of the leaders of MAPC. And he said that Reading has had the best turnout at any community meetings over the last year than any community they've ever worked with. And just for myself, at the last meeting I was at, they estimated 70 people or so, and I have to tell you, 40 of them at least I had never seen before talked to.
It's new people.
Every one of them came up to me just about and thanked us for asking them, which I thought was really interesting. It's like, well, thank you for coming. So that was good. And lastly, just to confirm and just to make it public, the board will hold a public hearing on tax classification at your next meeting on November 3rd, and that'll be at 7:30. So we just got some information from the DOR this morning that allows us to go forward.
Okay.
That's all.
Very good. Okay, so we want to give the chief the high sign.
Here with them too. This is great.
Evening.
Kind of a small
invasion.
Yeah, I know. We're used to it.
Always welcome.
Come on down, guys. They're welcome to come down front.
Down
bring them down front where they can see. Yeah.
Chief, how do you sit up front?
I usually stand.
Bring them in.
There they are.
There you go.
TV in the overflow.
We always should take 5 minutes before and after this. Plenty of room.
Guys, some breathing room there.
Come on in, guys.
How many more do you have out there?
Please, come on in.
Come on in.
Get everybody in.
She is there.
Excellent.
Got a couple seats up here.
Okay. Well, welcome one and all. Next to Brownie proclamations, this is my very favorite event as a selectman, and it's really what makes this job fun. John, did you have some comments you'd like to make?
So I've been gone for 6 weeks. You got to let me talk a little bit, right? And I will tell you that were it not for some of the people in this room that just walked into this room, I might not be here tonight. And I, you know, may very well have had a very extended stay, but I will tell you this. I had a pretty serious operation about 6 or 7 weeks ago that was going to have a 2 or 3 week recovery period. And then a pretty serious complication set in. And honestly, you know, the safety team of fire, police, emergency medical responded to a call that my son made 3 weeks ago. And I can't thank you all enough. It was, you know, I'm 65 years old, I never felt helpless. And 3 weeks ago, I was helpless. And these guys and their brothers came in and took over. And you know, I've said this to Chief Burns and Chief Cormier already, but you know what? Those weren't the guys standing in my bedroom hauling my big butt down the stairs. And I just want to say to the fire and police and emergency medical team, we have the best. They're professional. They couldn't be any better, in my opinion. And I personally want to thank you for what you did for me and my family.
Chiefs, whoever would like to go first, please take over.
Okay, well, thanks for having us here tonight.
Sure.
We have the honor to shift here as well. But, we have two new lieutenants introduced to you tonight, and also three firefighters, new firefighters. First, I'd like to introduce to you tonight Lieutenant Garrett Antonovica. Garrett has 8 years' experience with the Reading Fire Department. He has a master's degree in public administration and fire service management from Anna Maria College. He has a bachelor's degree in fire science from Anna Maria College. He's a licensed paramedic, and he graduated from New England EMS paramedic program run by Elliott Hospital. He's a graduate of the Massachusetts Firefighting Academy and certified as a firefighter 1 and 2. He's been working in the EMS field since 2003, and he's also had time working for a private ambulance company. Currently, Garrett, in addition to his duties as a lieutenant, is also our EMS liaison. And among his many other duties, he's responsible for our EMS training and keeping our EMS medications up to snuff and our other supplies. Garrett's also carrying on the family tradition of being a firefighter. His grandfather was a call firefighter in Leicester and also his father. So proud to have Garrett here, and I'd like to say thank you.
Thank you.
And I'd like, unfortunately his family couldn't be here tonight, so I'm pinch hitting. I'm going to pin his badge on. Gary's actually working tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Tonight, Scott Mayette. Scott's been with us for 12 years with the Reading Fire Department. He has a bachelor's degree in fire science from Columbia Southern University. He's a licensed paramedic and graduated from the Northeastern University paramedic program. He's also a graduate of the Mass Fire Academy and certified firefighter 1 and 2. He's got 13 years working in the EMS field. Scott served a number of years as our EMS liaison and very involved in our EMS training program and ordering supplies. Scott's also a certified open water, advanced open water, and rescue diver. And Scott was our Reading Firefighter of the Year in 2008, and he also received the Liberty Mutual Fire Mark Award in 2014. So I'd like to say congratulations to Scott. Scott's also carrying on the proud tradition. Scott's father is a captain in the Wakefield Fire Department for many years and recently retired. So who's going to pin your badge? Sure. I'd also like to introduce to you tonight Brian Yeager. Brian began working for the Reading Fire Department in May of this year. Brian's a United States Army veteran. He served in Iraq, and he's still serving in the Army Reserve as a senior medic. Brian has a Bachelor of Science degree in Geography and Regional Development from Salem State University. He's a graduate of the Massachusetts Firefighting Academy and certified firefighter 1 and 2. Brian's also a licensed paramedic, and he graduated from the Northern Essex Community College program in 2012. He has 4 years EMS experience, so we're glad to have him aboard. And I'd like to say welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
Brian's wife is going to pin the badge on the
the real boss.
That's
yeah.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
General.
Go home with him.
Come on, you want to? Oh, you want to?
There you go.
Nice. Oh no, don't get up, sir. It's okay. I'll come around. It's all right.
Congratulations.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
I'd also like to introduce you tonight, Eric Bagby. Eric's been working for the Reading Fire Department since May of this year as well. Currently, he's in the Massachusetts Firefighting Academy. He's got a little bit more of a week to go, so we've got him out late tonight. He's got to get back and rest up for tomorrow. He's a licensed paramedic, and he graduated from the New England EMS Institute paramedic program in 2012. Eric also worked for Lawrence General Hospital as a paramedic and been in the EMS field for 7 years. He began working as a EMS EMT technician as an EMT in 2008 and then moved up to paramedic in 2012. Eric has 7 years prior experience working as a a volunteer firefighter in the town of Pepper. So I'd like to say welcome.
Thank you.
Glad to have you. Eric's mother's going to pin the badge on. She's very sharp.
Hold on.
Got it.
Sorry, I have an injury.
To introduce you tonight, firefighter John Messer. John began working in the Reading Fire Department in May of 2015 as well. He's currently attending the Mass Fire Academy with Eric, so we'll have to get him home tonight early as well. John has extensive EMS experience. He's got 23 years in the EMS field. He graduated from Northeastern University paramedic program in 1995, and he completed the Northern Essex Community College EMT program in 1991. In addition to his EMS experience, he's also has 7 years experience working for the Middleton Fire Department as a firefighter and dispatcher. The Middleton Fire Chief gave him a great recommendation, although he was not happy that he stole him away. So I'm glad to have you here, John.
Thank you, Chief.
Again, and as we spoke earlier, a number of us were speaking about what a fun event these are. They really are. The officers and the promotions and the families really appreciate the board taking the time and recognizing these accomplishments. Congratulations to all the firefighters, the new firefighters and the promotions. That's great news. You know, our brothers and sisters in the fire department are doing a great job over there, as John alluded to earlier in his experience. We work very well together, hand in glove, and it's a really great professional relationship that we have with the fire service. I'm here this evening to introduce Tim Barrett, our newest police officer. Tim has the distinction of being probably the last one of these that I'll be doing. I know there's a whole bunch of people back at the police station that wish they could say that. But Tim's going to be the one. So, you know, Tim recently graduated from the police academy, and so give you a little background on Tim. Tim currently lives in town here with his wife and their newborn daughter. He comes to us via Xavier Brothers High School in Westwood, attended Westfield State University, got a bachelor's degree in criminal justice and an undergrad degree or a minor in psychology, which will help him immensely both inside the building and outside working in the public safety field. But we're very happy to have him. Like I say, he just graduated from the Reading Police Academy in August. He's gone through his 3 months of field training, and today was his last day. He risked it though this evening and almost had to go back for some remedial training. Luckily you were running a little late. But we're very happy to have Tim aboard. We're looking forward to it, and I just will put a little plug in. I know we're going to have a discussion with the board in a couple of weeks about future expenditures for the police department and things that are going to be coming forward. Tim happens to be a small plane pilot. So, you know, as we talk about future, you know, capital investments, you may want to consider, you know, thinking about something in the aircraft field, you know. Just a thought, something to think about. Well, we'll see, you know.
Sell for a drone.
Whatever the two of us can fit in and he can fly is the way I look at it, but we'll go from there. So, Tim's going to be pinned this evening by his wife, Kimberly. She's right over here. We'll ask her to come up. And you see his daughter, Madeline, over there in the back row. Hello. Thank you.
That was it.
So,
thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, seeing as how this may be the last one of these I do, and I'll take the risk of doing it again, because I always kind of mess this part up, if you guys remember.
Oh, yeah.
I usually go around and try to recognize all the officers that he has and point them out, because a lot of them come, you know, to pay tribute to the new officer, and I usually miss somebody, but I'll try not to tonight. So we get Deputy Chief Mark Sagala, Sergeant Christopher Jones, Sergeant Pat Silva. You go around. If there's anybody sitting here that I'm missing that's in plain clothes, please point yourselves out. Lieutenant Richard Boddy in the back. Detective Pat Iapica over there next to Martha. Coming around, Officer Michael Scouten, Sergeant Christine Amendola, Officer Matthew Orr, Detective Michael Saunders. Okay, I'm going to say it now. Is there anyone here from the police department that I didn't mention?
Okay, well done.
I think I got that one right. It's the first time I've gotten that one right. Okay, so thank you for that. Thank you very much,
thank
and as
you.
The Sarge used to say at the beginning of Hill Street Blues, let's be careful out there.
Thank you.
Appreciate that.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Let's do a 5-minute recess, please.
Yeah, no, that's what I say.
School committee last night heard this presentation, a longer and more detailed version.
I'm going to give you guys the abridged.
Okay.
So, essentially, we're all aware that we have a management letter comment from fiscal 14 audit that points to our revolving funds growing, some with 6 months to 24 months of expenditures for balances. So that obviously was concerning, and so we need to take a look. And there were four that were of primary concern that they were included in the school department. Martha was nice enough to sit with me on several occasions and work through a lot of how did we come up with these support numbers, and because we weren't sure what the source of the problem was. I kind of knew, I could see that on the onset we had issues where I'd see that the budget supported a certain level and then they would take a less than. So I figured that might be part of it, but we wanted to make sure that we weren't missing the revenue and the expense side. Are we charging too much for these programs? Are we not charging the right all the expenses to the program? You know, is there something more than just what I could see on the onset, which was the support not fully being taken as budget? And when we dug in, I learned a lot about the programs that had been done prior. The first one we looked at, I think, was full-day kindergarten, and Martha had pulled out something that she had found that had been done back in 2010, and I carved out the expenses for one full-day kindergarten class, and then it, you know, extrapolated for how many classes, and back then it was maybe 8, and now we have 11, or maybe it was less than that, but we now have 11. So it hadn't been done since 2010, so Martha agreed to sit down and put the numbers in for fiscal 15 so we could see if our support that we budgeted was a reasonable amount of support. And the number came to about $963,000 for the full-day kindergarten program. And so my immediate response was, well, our support was somewhere in the 800s, 840 or whatever it was. Why didn't we do support of 963? And I learned things that I wouldn't have known otherwise, which is there are people in the full-day kindergarten program that are IEP, and that means that they don't have to pay tuition for full-day kindergarten. There are people who qualify because of income qualifications to have either reduced tuition or free tuition. So there are a certain number of people within that group that are paying tuition, and they are the responsibility of the general fund. And so that's why the full amount is not being, the process really helped me understand a little bit more of there's more to it than just, okay, how much does it cost? Well, you're gonna pull all that, you know? There's more to it. And we were able to get very close to what the budget support was, so I felt pretty comfortable that, and also the tuition itself. I mean, we took that number divided by the number of participants in the program, it came out to 4224, and they charged 4200. So I felt comfortable that the fee for full-day kindergarten was in the range of what it cost us to run the program. So I felt like, okay, that's not a problem. And it looked like the expenses were what I would expect to see, you know, the paraprofessionals, the teachers. There was nothing that was like outrageous being charged, and there wasn't anything that stood out to me as, you know, missing. And so we felt pretty comfortable that it was, at one point, somebody must have really put a lot of time into figuring out what that tuition would be, and we've probably been just increasing it by the percentage of our increase for our wage. So even though it hadn't been looked at since 2010, it seemed like it still was an appropriate number. So we felt comfort there, and when we looked at other funds, we found similar, you know, we had to look at things in a different way. Special ed, for instance, we run a program to save us money in special ed, and we have neighboring communities that pay a tuition to send their children here. And so we would be running the program anyways, but this kind of helps buffer the costs so that we can charge tuition out. And so it was really hard to kind of say how much of that expense to run the program is supposed to go here, because it wasn't meant, this revolving fund wasn't meant to cover the full cost, it was meant to help. And so we had to come at that in different angles. And we still felt like it was a reasonable cost in the way that we came up with it. And I still felt like the primary problem I could see consistently with the three out of the four was that the support was the problem. And the issue started to really be obvious in fiscal 13, where there was a significant difference in what was budgeted for support and what was taken in support. So I was.
Could you explain what you mean by that exactly? Support.
So what happens is, in your general fund budget, the school committee has a budget for education, and they have everything. Their teachers, everything that takes to run the education programs, is in the general fund budget. And they would have a line item that would say revolving fund support, and it would be a negative expense. So basically, it would be counting on a revolving fund to come in and refund the general fund for some of the expenditures, because they're paying on behalf of a program. Like full-day kindergarten, we're only required to provide half-day kindergarten. So full-day should be covering the other half. And so, but all of the expenses are actually being paid out of the general fund, and the revolving fund is supposed to pay it back, kind of. And what I'm seeing is that those budgeted supports seem to be appropriate amounts of support, but for whatever reason, and not knowing the reasoning, they didn't always take the full amount of the support. And it could be some of that they projected certain enrollment, IEPs, and things like that. Maybe the numbers didn't work out exactly as they projected. However, in fiscal 13, something seemed to be very wrong, in that there was a big discrepancy between the support and what was taken, and it became very apparent that they were growing. It made the number go up so much in each one of them that it stood out. And I think the auditors noticed it, maybe asked some questions, and then fiscal 14 it went up again. They didn't go down, and I think that's why we got the comment.
So has this been an allocation problem?
I think it's not an allocation problem. I think from my standpoint, and this is just my opinion, I don't know, but I do feel like it looked to me like, you know, that particular year was a good year and they didn't need the support to make everything work, so they just didn't take as much. That's what it looks like to me. But I don't know that that, I don't, without asking the question of the person who's making that decision, I don't know what went into that decision to reduce the amount of support. I know what they budgeted, and I saw what they moved, and it wasn't.
So if you have an excess balance carried over, is that taken into consideration when the following year's charges are set to the parents, the tuition rates?
What do you mean, the excess balance in the revolving fund?
Yeah, is that used to perhaps reduce? Is that, can you do that?
No, well, I mean, I guess you could, but it usually is year to year, you should be charging what it costs you to run the program for the year. And that money that's just kept in there should be minimal, enough to kind of give you some extra money in there in case you have slow pays and, you know, cash flow issues. But for the most part, that's not even that big of a deal, because the general fund in most cases is actually paying all the expenses, and in the end of the year I'm taking the support. So cash flow isn't even that big of an issue. So it's hard to know how much these funds should be able to hold and not draw attention, because the law is very gray about it. And so it's all up to interpretation in terms of how much money is appropriate to be in there. You have a question?
Yes, Sharon, I went through the document over the weekend. I had several questions. It sounds like there's two related, for those at home, two related transactions. One is the income of funds from those benefiting from the program paying in tuition, and then the transfer of some sum of money called support to the general budget to reimburse the general budget for the cost of the educators and the administrators and the staff to provide that. And the issue at hand is the two are generally matched.
Yes.
But in 13, and in fact in 2014, there's
13 and 14 is where it really
some substantial anomalies that crept in.
And that's where we had a problem. I think that there was always maybe a building of 10 or 20,000 that keep making it grow, but it was growing substantially in those years, which is what drew it.
And I understand from you tonight that there isn't any text of accounts or text of that describes the way that the offset should be managed. That's completely within the latitude of the financial group or the school committee?
I mean, there's laws governing how these funds are supposed to be managed. However, it's not, they don't actually name a dollar amount or a percentage that you can maintain. They say you can roll the balance from year to year, but they don't say how much that balance can be.
It seems to me, though, that one of the recommendations might be a text of accounts.
I guess I don't know what you mean by text of accounts. I'm sorry.
This is almost an offset account, and you almost want a textual description to describe for future generations either the way it's been managed and therefore provide some continuity.
Yeah.
Just as a set of breadcrumbs to teach those going forward. So you don't have these,
how do we do
this?
A
policy, if you will.
Yes. Okay, I see what you mean. Yeah, it definitely is something maybe we should be working on, maybe Martha and I together, to put together something that, so that, you know, years from now when this has kind of been fixed, that it doesn't happen again, that there's something in place to help somebody say, how do I manage this? And I think that's part of it, is that there's a lack of understanding of what is considered appropriate. Am I required to take the full amount of the support that I budget?
Right.
But by not taking it, you are kind of making the general fund absorb some
that's
of the costs of
point,
the program. And that, to me, kind of...
You have less flexibility.
Less flexibility, because I feel like what happens is you've trapped money into a fund that can only be used for that specific purpose, and it's hard to get it out of there, because by law, I can't take anything more out of that fund in that year than what it costs to run that program. So for the example of full-day kindergarten, I probably could have them pull 963 or something out of this year.
Run it down.
But, like I couldn't take a dime more. So it's going to take us time to get them to right themselves, because we're going to have to draw them down in a slower fashion.
That's where this policy thing would help, particularly in this transition period where you're trying to establish a more normal balance.
Exactly.
You both describe the transition period and then what steady state is.
And we also
going.
Have to determine what is reasonable. Like, what does DOE and DOR think is a reasonable reserve to be held in there, so that we know what we're guiding people towards. You shouldn't be going over a certain amount, because I think you're doing a budgeted support, and it's budgeted on all sorts of factors, enrollment, and what you think is going to be IEP and that, and all that. And it doesn't always come out the way you projected. So there's going to be anomalies there, and it's going to be problems there in what you projected. So there should be reasons that you can take less support or more support, because things don't work out the way you think. And also, too, if you budgeted, let's say, $350,000 and that cost, I mean, that you get in 360, keeping that 10,000 in there isn't that big a deal. You know, small, you know, but over time it will grow a little bit and you have a little bit of wiggle room. And it's, but there is a certain feeling that, you know, budget certainty. If you're budgeting for the next year and you know that in your revolving fund you already have enough in there for next year, that gives them confidence that they're not going to have a problem making that support. And I can understand where there would be a tendency to go that direction, although it seems frowned upon, as we're learning now, by the auditors and by DOR. But it also is very unclear in the law. So I feel like you just, it's very difficult to know where that line is. I remember asking the questions about it when I first got here. I know Gail had, I had conversations with Gail. Gail's like, it's definitely not well defined. And so you can't push back really hard if there isn't like a line that's drawn that you could say, I really disagree with what you're doing
right
here.
But the legal is only one dimension of it. I view that as the extreme, that's the minimum or the maximum behavior we can expect. There ought to be, from a policy perspective, what does the town of Reading expect? Just as we have kind of a normal and expected behavior.
And we could have a policy.
Day to day, it's
yeah,
more of a
exactly.
policy. To Dan's earlier point as we opened up, to the extent that budgets come under pressure, to the degree we can fully expend this money over the next few years, it helps provide some small amount of relief
mm-hmm.
from the general
if we,
budget.
And in the way that Martha had budgeted out forward, she was taking extra for the next 3 years to try and bring it down. But you still have limitations on how much you
sure.
can pull. So like I said, it's going to be a slow draw down to a normal position, I think.
Yes, very.
I actually had the benefit of watching the entire presentation last night, and I went through pretty extensively the handout that had been sent out. And you know, this was an issue that's been kind of causing questions for a long time in terms of, you know, why are these growing? And especially in terms of light of the conversation, Dan, that you brought up, and going to be our last agenda item, I think it's really important. And I really want to compliment Martha and Sharon on really working together and coming up and just sort of highlighting this, given the auditor's, you know, the auditor's report. You know, at a time perhaps when we may be going to the voters and asking for some more assistance, it's really good to know that we've looked at kind of how our budget works. The fact that you guys worked together and came up with this and presented to the school committee and got, you know, what looked like assurances from the school committee that, you know, that we're going to be watching this going forward, I think that gives the community a lot of, you know, a lot of positive about sort of making sure that we're spending all of our money wisely, that there's nothing that can cause questions. So I want to thank you really both for working together. You know, it's refreshing to have that. I would encourage you to keep doing that going forward. You know, it's all one big pie.
It
and we need to really work together and, you know, create the right optics. So I really do want to compliment you on doing that. And
we seem to be in agreement about what the issue really was and where it started and what do we do to fix it. Obviously, we're limited in what we can do to fix it, and it's going to take some time. And then it will keep us monitoring it more closely. We see how it fell off track, and now we know what we need to be looking for. And also, had this not happened, the school committee wouldn't know what to be looking for either. They didn't know, you know, that this was a problem. I didn't really know for sure it was a problem in terms of how much are we allowed to have in there. And because the law doesn't draw it out for you, you just don't know. So the management letter comment just kind of points to, well, our auditors thinks it's a problem. And when it went up in front of DOR, they felt it was a problem, so we need to correct it. And you know, we just learn from it, we move on.
How long is it going to take? I'm sorry. How long is it going to take to draw this down?
It will take a while. I mean, we're going to be drawing down for the 3 years that, you know, we went 3 years in advance. Was it 3 years you did in advance?
I projected out, well, FY16 and then 17 and 18.
Yeah.
So.
But
okay.
We will probably, the longer, if the balance maintains at that level, we will continue to draw down until we get to what we consider to be a normal level. But we also have to identify
what
is that level.
Right.
Yeah.
But also, too, if you're taking the supports and the thing is still growing, then that sort of informs you that, well, maybe we're, you know, the fees might be able to be dropped, or maybe you're not addressing the adequate costs. So I think just keeping an eye
on it, and doing more of this, like, kind of proof of what the support is. And, like, is this a reasonable tuition that we're charging or fee? And is the support that we're asking this fund to draw appropriate? we will be watching it more closely. Anytime something comes up that we weren't watching closely enough, you're looking at it every year more closely. It's a learning process, and I think that it will ultimately right itself. Nobody wants to draw bad attention in our direction. It wasn't an intentional. I don't believe it was.
Right, especially now.
Yeah, I don't think it was intended to be this way, but I do think that it will go right, and we're all on the same page. There's no disagreement about the fact that it needs to be done, and so I think that we have a good plan going forward. We work well together, Mark and I. I think it will really be beneficial, because there's no disagreement about what needs to be done. I mean, we've even had conversations on the revolving funds where it's not meant to fully support the program. Maybe if the revenue comes in more than the support, you might take more than what you budgeted for support, because maybe that's what needs to happen because you've collected more, you know, or maybe you let it sit there and in a year that we need it, you maybe pull a little bit more. So we have talked about different options of, you know, making this work. And I don't think it's the end of it. I think there's an ongoing discussion that will be happening between Martha and I and the school committee and board of selectmen. It will probably be talked about again just as we continue to look at it. And, you know, because one of the ones we looked at was extended day, and that fund blew up, and the support wasn't the problem. It was that it just grew so fast, and I don't think they staffed up. It doesn't look like the expenses match what they really need to be to really run that program. And that director is really spending a lot of time processing payments, which is more of an administrative function. That director should be planning and enriching the program. So talking about that, you know, and if this hadn't happened, maybe we wouldn't be looking as closely. So sometimes bad things can happen and it makes us do better. So I do think it's going to go in the right direction. I'm very positive about it. So do you have any more questions about it?
I do. I have a couple of questions and a couple of comments. One is, I would echo what
Barry has just said, is that the idea that you and Martha have worked together to actually identify what hard costs look like, and, you know, to really kind of take the thing apart, put it on the table, look at it, and then be able to decide what to do from there. But to John Arena's point, I think one of the things we have to be very careful of, and I'm glad to hear that we've got a plan in place to run this down. You know, it's my opinion that the support needs to be taken. And I just...
We're agreeing in that.
It's, yeah, so the support needs to be taken, whether it's... It's not a question of legal.
Mm-hmm.
It's a question of... And it's not just a question of optics either. It's a question of doing the right thing. We are looking down the barrel of some significant asks that we're going to have to be making to the citizens of this town. And at least two-thirds of that is tied to, you know, the or more needs to be expended into the school system. I think we kind of all know and agree with that. So it becomes incumbent, I would say, that A, the transparency level's high, you know, B, that there's a constant revisitation, that, you know, value received is going on, that we're not putting inappropriate undue pressure on the general fund, mm-hmm. when we've got the opportunity for support. I mean, and these are things, I agree with you, Sharon, that had the auditors not brought this up, I never, honestly, I don't think anybody has ever thought that there was a nefarious behavior going on. It was nothing like that. But it was like, you know, you look at this thing and it's quacking. Is this thing a duck? I mean, you know, honestly. And so pretty soon what you have to do is, and, you know, the auditors made us do that. And I think that I was sitting in that meeting when that report came out. And I think it was a good thing. It sounds like this is a very healthy fiscal process, mm-hmm. that we're in the middle of right now. And I think it's going to lend itself to a discussion that Dan launched earlier tonight and that several of us have echoed, that we've got some very tough decisions going forward. We don't need any distractions, mm-hmm. tied to, you know, not that we're doing anything illegal, but that we might be doing something that, you know, isn't out in the public eye and easy to understand. You guys are making it very easy to understand. I think that's very appropriate. And I think, you know,
it's all, it all moves forward in a positive way, although challenging going forward. But I just want to encourage that we use every bit of that support to give the relief to the general fund so that we can have an honest discussion with the taxpayers about what needs to happen. Programs need to not suffer. You know, people that should be building program for extended day shouldn't be doing bookkeeping.
I didn't realize
you know, I mean, you know, and I'm not trying to nitpick. All I'm trying to say is, I think, you know, I think in a general way the people in this town are very interested in high levels of education and high levels of quality program and extended opportunities for the children in this town and therefore the families in this town. So I think I applaud the direction, and you know, I think we should all be talking about this together a lot.
Just two quick unrelated comments. I think this also sets a precedent for the way the town and the schools can work together for any future similar sort of event where there's a need to dig in and kind of do some forensic work and figure out what the source of the problem is. And to your point, Sharon, I don't think any of this arises from acts of commission. There are oversights and anomalies that may have quite innocent origins, and it's more how you recover than how you got there. The other comment is, in the report, there are comparables to a number of other educational institutions. I'm looking at the page on RISE, page 5. To the degree you're looking at non-public institutions, you're comparing the operating cost of a public school against the total cost, the total cost of operating a business of a private institution, and they've got capital expense and depreciation in their numbers, and the schools wouldn't. So to some extent, those comparables would never be
equal.
Think
it wasn't meant to, I think it was more meant to see that we're not overcharging.
Correct.
And also too, you know, Landmark was one of the comparables I think you saw there. Landmark's a very expensive school. If we were too close to that tuition, I don't think we'd be drawing other communities to send somebody here for some cost savings.
Correct.
And so that was kind of some of the intent of the slide to say, okay, I don't think it's overcharged. And then there were other components, because we had a slide there that talked about the costs that worked in and how we arrived at the 34.5 or whatever it was that we're charging. That was just kind of meant to say, compared to
what?
An alternative,
right.
Where are we?
Right.
Not necessarily. We're not a private school, but and Landmark is very well known for how well they do for the type of program we were running, and so that was one of the only alternatives we could find that was a comparable. And if you're staying well below what they're charging, we're a good option.
That's more the point, as long as you're suitably below.
Yeah, exactly, and I think that was the reason Martha chose to put the slide in there.
Thank you.
Sure. Any other questions from the board?
Just keep working together.
Well, this is great progress. Pleased to hear this report tonight. Let's stay in touch with each other, and hopefully this gets itself worked out over the coming years. You might want to also consider how you might want to package this report to town meeting, because I know this was raised on the floor.
Good point.
It will come up.
Yeah.
For sure.
Maybe Matt can help with the PR on this, you know, how we ought to be doing it. There's various ways we can do it.
Because it was something that drew attention.
The report under article or whatever it is, 2-1, I guess.
Well, you know, interestingly, the report that you did is very your the notes that we got, your report of last night, is very transparent.
Yeah.
And I think that's what town meeting is going to look for. That's what they're going to want. That is always what they're calling for.
They just want all the information. Yeah.
Yeah. And in a format that's kind of easy to
digest,
because, you know, much as everybody at town meeting, you know, has probably the best of intentions to do all kinds of homework. Lives are busy, and you know what?
That warrant gets to be a lot to read.
It does. I mean, it really does. Good work, as far as I'm concerned.
Questions or comments? Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Let's keep
going. Well, I did have other things to go over with you, other than the revolving fund.
Yeah.
The fund balance policy was something that was requested as part of the management letter. It was basically to address changes that were made in the GASB 54, which addresses governmental accounting. So for our financial statements that we put out, that's where you would see these different we used to call it undesignated fund balance and reserve fund balance, and then these five new categories were introduced, which were non-spendable. I think they just wanted us to have a policy that acknowledges what we put in these categories. These things are defined in our financial statements. They just wanted us to acknowledge it with a policy. So it's just officially putting what's in our disclosures and our financial statements kind of in a policy that's acknowledged by the Board of Selectmen as this is the way it's done. Right. This is exactly where things fall. So for non-spendable, it's inventory and permanent things that are not spendable. So a permanent fund is something like if somebody requests a scholarship fund and they said the principal is unspendable and you can only spend the interest. Well, then that portion that's unspendable sits in a spot where I can't spend it. So that's where you would put that non-spendable balance. And then inventory is not cash, so it's not in liquid form, so it would not be in any of the other categories. It would be in non-spendable. Restricted is when a third party is telling you that you have to spend it for a certain purpose. That could be the MSBA, it could be something with debt covenants, it could be grants. Committed is the highest level of authority is making the decision to commit the balance, commit money towards something, and that would be town meeting. And then, of course, if we wanted to take something away, it would require town meeting to take it back, rescind it. Assigned is essentially our encumbrances. It's basically what we, the town manager or his designee, which would be his department heads, decide to encumber, which is POs and reserve money is set aside for contracts that we're signing and such. So that's essentially what those four categories, and unassigned is there's nothing. Then it's just available to be spent for whatever in the upcoming year. So they break our fund balance down into these categories, and they just wanted us to have a policy in place that talks about that we acknowledge the Board of Selectmen knows where we're putting these on the financial statements. And then on the other hand, they also wanted to know what fund balance level we are comfortable with, or an internal policy in terms of reserves. And we do have one through FinCom, which is a 5% reserves between the stabilization and free cash. And so I pretty much put that in writing. There's been some talk about increasing it, so I did put that the goal is 7% and that anything lower than 5 is gonna be cause for concern, and that would be requiring the town manager to make some action to kind of eliminate any discretionary spending to try and turn more money back to increase that reserve. And that's up for discussion. That's just me throwing something out there as a draft so that you guys can have something to start with and then talk about the numbers you feel comfortable. It is an internal policy. There's nobody who would be holding you accountable for it, but it's something you make a decision on where you feel comfortable. FinCom already kind of has the 5% policy, so it's basically just expanding on that a little bit. But it's certainly something to talk about. I just put what I thought you might want, and you certainly can have some feedback on it.
Okay.
Question.
It's a bit of a nit, but you described the goal as equal to 7%. You mean at or above, I presume, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, and I can change the wording right. if any of, it's kind of a draft at this point,
right.
but...
Right.
Them seeing us put it on paper and present it to the Board of Selectmen, they don't need you to necessarily approve it tonight unless you feel comfortable with it, but it's something that they would like to see us adopt at some point in the near future so that they feel comfortable that we address the management.
I think this is great. This is another one of those policy documents that helps make clear for legislators and taxpayers and town meeting members alike how capital funds and how fund balances are might appear to be in the balance sheet, but they're actually already allocated, and you really can't touch them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And if they're reading our financial statements, they'd understand what they're
well, doing. And I do think that John brings up a valid point about, and it's a very small point in a very good document.
Right.
The at or above 7, mm-hmm. I think is a fair thing.
It's definitely a modification.
I think that's a fair thing to add. And I say that because, we do have to... for several years now, I've kind of said we need to maintain these levels because things happen.
Our AAA rating is really attributable to
precisely.
The
and what I don't want to have happen is I don't want somebody to be able to construe this document as saying, "Oh, wait a minute, they're at 7.9%."
Yeah, yeah.
Let's just spend that.
friendly amendment, I'll change it to whatever you want to do.
Because I actually could sort of hear somebody saying that.
Absolutely.
You know, and I think we need to leave that in a way that gives some latitude to not only, you know, who we are and how we look at budgets, but FinCom, and I don't think that we should suddenly create a rule that says, this is the ceiling, you know, spend down the rest of it.
Right.
I don't think we ever really had that as a in our policy. That
no, but we've actually talked about those two numbers. Those two numbers have surfaced. I think when you were chairing the FinCom, those were numbers we actually kicked around a little bit.
Or 8%,
you
know?
Right. We tried to,
something
right.
in that range.
Yeah. So that's why I'm saying, all I'm suggesting is don't box yourself in here.
This was kind of a document that wasn't even out there. It's like they asked all of their clients to do it, and like, okay, where do I begin? It took a while to even think about, what are you asking me to do? You know, like,
this is
define
a really,
several
this
things,
is a,
like,
nice
define define where we put things in terms of our fund balance categories, and then define what the fund balance is that we're hoping mm-hmm. to achieve and maintain. And then they actually want us to talk about the order of which funds are used in terms of mm-hmm. if you have multi-sources for a project,
right.
what do you use first? Because when mm-hmm. there's money left over, are you refunding it back to a grant because
right,
you're
yes.
using it last?
Right.
We're going to use the most restricted funds first. A grant is going to get used first. I'm
right.
not giving it back to them. I'm
right.
giving it
right.
back to free cash.
Right.
So, and that's naturally being done, and that's what they assume, but they want it in writing. They want to know that this is a decision that the Board of Selectmen is comfortable with.
Sharon, these are issues that all cities and towns have to deal with.
Sure.
Was there any kind of is there any guidance from, let's say, Mass Municipal Association about language? Because all their members need to be. I mean,
I've
you shouldn't
never
have
seen this
you shouldn't
come
have
up.
300 town accountants trying to
figure
just,
it out.
We just need
do
one
that.
To start.
Right. But why is always Reading's the first one to like?
Well,
set the
we're going to create the best practice.
There were actually yeah. others that you know. I got a couple templates that we reached out to our listservs and say, okay, what do you have? And you put it together
right.
based on what you see other communities coming up with. And I think a lot of Melanson and Heath's clients
yeah.
particularly were asked to do this. I don't know that all town accountants were asked to do it, so I didn't see it come up in any public conferences for Mass Municipal Accountants. But it should have, because I think all of us who were asked to do it were a little bit like, I'm not sure what I'm being asked to do. Is this what you want? And before I put this in front of you, I did send it to Melanson. He's saying, is this what you're looking for? And they said, yes, this is exactly what we're looking for.
You can present this at your next conference.
Yeah. Yeah. You could be, you can present the paper.
Here's the format.
That's a valuable document
this
for town meeting.
This is Sharon's policy.
Yeah, yeah.
And you haven't shared this with the FinCom yet?
No.
Just right off the presses?
The concept, yes, but not a document.
Yeah, we haven't shared a document. And as far as Melanson and Heath is interested, they just really wanted the Board of Selectmen to approve it. But I think
yeah.
it is a FinCom document as well. So it's certainly something we can present at another meeting with FinCom. But just so that it is, the conversation has started, there's a draft form, and we will not see this as a management letter comment this year because they've
good.
Seen it.
Good.
But we do need to accept something. We need to talk about that language, about the level that we feel comfortable with the reserves. And if you're comfortable with the 5 and 7 and changing those words and approving it as is, that's fine. Or if you want to see FinCom look at it first, whatever you feel comfortable with. They pretty much told me because they see it and they know that it's on paper, that it's on its way to being approved, and we will not see the comment. Of course, if they never see it get approved, I think that would be a problem. But for this year, they're not.
Well, we're going to be in the financial forum in a week, right?
Yeah.
Yeah,
and so we're going to be both in session.
Yeah,
maybe we present it there.
Yeah, maybe you
yeah.
make those small amendments
sure.
we talked about, and I think this is a really valuable document for lots of reasons.
Oh yeah, we got them all in. I don't know that we get that one though. So
we've asked FinCom three times for a path to approve an OPEB policy.
So the other things I have for you are very quick. Today, free cash was certified,
yes.
thank God.
Yeah,
saw that.
Because
yep.
we do need
Hallelujah.
To use free
Healthy
cash
balance.
For November town meeting.
And that was the right. That was a number you were thinking of, right? It wasn't less or more. Than
no. It's 200,000 higher than what it was last year. So essentially, we used $2.8 million in free cash last year since it was certified.
And regenerated.
And we regenerated 1.6 in revenues over budget, 1.6 with expenses under budget. A lot of those expenses under budget were positions that went unfilled. And so we spent the 2.8, we regenerated 3.2. There's certain adjustments that DOR makes, because if we don't collect cash from grants in time, like I think we have September 30th is the cutoff. If we end the year in a deficit, meaning we spent the money but they haven't reimbursed us yet, it's as if the money was borrowed from the general fund and they deduct from your free cash, because they don't want to see you spend it, and then if you never get the money, you know, so that's essential. So when all the adjustments are said and done, you end up at 8.7, a little, actually just under 8.8 in free cash.
How much of the unspent budget is attributable to the positions that we're trying to hire but we haven't or can't? So, because that's, I mean, that we shouldn't.
Somewhere between 400,000 and 500,000.
So
it's a lot.
Yeah.
That's so that really is the delta of growth,
right?
You know, so, and that's important to point out, particularly tied to our, you know, to our, some of our previous
there
comments.
There is a piece of it that's attributable to capital projects that came in above what we had asked for, and then we couldn't do them.
Yeah, we had to back away, right. and we're going to have to.
So it's not like those expenses exist. We just haven't figured out a way to spend them yet.
Yeah, we need to spend them.
So it kind of makes it look like it's more than it is.
It makes it look like we're budgeting high, but sometimes it's that we don't get to certain work, or it comes in over budget, and we can't do the work because we didn't ask for enough. Or
it shows an artificially positive number.
It does. Right. It does. And I don't know that it's always going to go this direction for us. And I feel like every year I say it, and every year it goes our direction. And I don't know.
Right.
And Bob says it too. I'm not going to say that anymore.
No, I stopped 2 years
ago. But I think that's really important to point out, and, you know, at the forum, at town meeting, because I can just envision, well, you know, you regenerated all this free cash. We don't need the money. But in fact, you know, you nearly need to dig deeper.
All we do is defer expenses.
We really did.
It's all we really. That's how the money is gone.
Right.
We just happen to be.
But at the end,
possessing it at the end
of the Ponzi scheme, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Someone's left with. Someone's left with the expenses, right? And you know, we don't want to be this board. No, but we can't kick the can down the road.
Just to our earlier discussion, you, in a circumstance where you don't have sufficient funding to launch a project, you can't encumber the funds you have, and then, therefore.
Technically, you should be under contract to be able to encumber.
And it's not a liability.
So you
got to
give it back.
You don't have the money, you can't encumber.
You can't show it as a liability, as a future spend. Right?
We sometimes do a portion if it's divisible, like an engineering study.
Yeah, like between 2 years.
And then we can't do the construction, so we kick back whatever's left.
I see.
Thinking especially enterprise.
Something's in progress at year end, like we're doing the legal documents. We've already done the bid. I'll allow somebody to encumber it even without the contract, but it really has to be in progress. I mean, because otherwise it just looks like you're trying to hold funds from the prior and bring them forward, and that's not.
Well, it harkens back to the discussion we had earlier about the schools.
Yeah.
I mean, optics matter to taxpayers, and it's not. You know, the sake of optics, it's the sake of doing it the right way, not necessarily what's technically legal.
And you want to do the projects right. You
correct.
Want to shortchange the project either.
Right.
So it's really a hard choice to turn it back and ask for it again, because it makes us look silly in some ways. But sometimes you just don't know what the true cost
is. Those are the rules of the game.
Bob, is it possible, just to echo Mr. Halsey's comments, if we started with free cash regeneration and tried to break that out as to what the sources of that regeneration were, and identify whether it's unfunded positions or unfunded work, or what are the other subcategories. It might be an interesting way to describe why that apparent positive is something slightly different.
Yeah, Sharon did that for FinCom, and
I have it all here.
I had about two-thirds of it in my notes from listening to her. And some of it's a good thing. We saved money because we did something smarter. Most of it's not a good thing. We couldn't spend the money.
Most of it's happenstantial, it sounds like to me. And I think it's important that people know that.
We couldn't deliver a service or a quality of a service because we didn't have the staff, because we couldn't hire them.
Right.
So we saved money.
Right.
Is that a good thing?
But it's the narrative that's important. If we went back like two or three, just a couple of years, and could show, you know, 13, 14, 15, why that regeneration's got a story behind it that you might not entirely understand and you might not like.
We do have a spreadsheet that shows each year where the sources of it is.
That's,
I think we've seen
that's
that
important
at
information.
Finance Forum. I can update that
and
come along. Sometimes it's hard for people to understand it because it's a very involved spreadsheet, but I could talk somebody through it.
That's where a chart might come in handy.
Yeah, a chart might
come in. 4 or 5 years would be an easier thing to digest.
And like you said, a table or a chart instead
of seeing
table
all, that would spin out of
pivot,
that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would spin out of that spreadsheet.
Don't go daffy on me. It's one of those lines, you know.
I like pivot table.
Pivot tables
I use them all
are
the
very
time.
Descriptive.
We call it a bar chart.
So I guess I just wanted to just mention a couple more things to you. We did have our water, sewer, and storm all certified as well.
Thing.
Water is at about $3.2 million in surplus.
Yeah.
Sewer is just over $4 million. And stormwater is at $950,000. So all very healthy numbers. So we're very fortunate in that arena because I think we'll be needing some for projects and such.
Right.
And then the auditors were here just a couple weeks ago, and they were very pleased. They didn't find anything of concern. They're not done quite yet because they brought a lot of the work. I just bury them in paperwork, and then they go back to the office and contact me.
Just to draw an analogy, we carry what we think is an appropriate balance in water and sewer reserves, but we can use that to offset water rates and
mm-hmm.
sewer rates.
And you
absolutely.
Have.
Apparently, you don't have that same option as cleanly with the tuition.
No,
correct.
No.
That's where I was kind of.
Because
I had a bad
those revolving funds for school are set up by a different law altogether. Like for the inspections revolving fund, I think if you recall the last town meeting, we used $140,000 towards something completely unrelated to the purpose of the fund because we have that flexibility. DOR says you that type of fund, you can come to town meeting and ask us to use it for something else, and it's okay. You do not have that flexibility with these school funds.
Right.
They're set up under a different law with much more restriction. They want to be sure that this money goes towards those types of programs. And in some cases, unfortunately, I think that there's free cash in there and I can't get it out. So what can you do, right? And so the audit is not complete, but they are working on it. They will be coming back to do a student activities audit as part of their departmental testing, but also we are required every so many years to have an actual student activities audit, and so it kind of kills two birds with one stone because that's what they're doing. That's what audit committee happened to select as one of their
a student audit.
Student activities.
Student activity fees.
You know those student activities.
Oh,
well,
right. I'm yeah, right.
So the area that the audit committee decided was they wanted probed.
Are you a student?
That's a very
high
risk
that committee, and so I, you know, I can say that what happens is. There is a table that says this is the last time we audited X. This is the last time we audited Y.
We're cycling through. There's no specific reason why.
We hadn't asked for that a while ago, too, I think.
But they do need to take a certain amount of them in every cycle.
That's right.
To audit.
I internally audit them, but not. But now there's this new checklist, pretty extensive one that Martha or I have to do every year, and then every third year the audit firm or a third party will need to do it. That is going to happen this year because they're going to do it twofold because we picked it as a departmental testing and it happens to be the year we need to have it done. So they're not done, so I'm sure you'll be hearing about that audit soon, hopefully. And so far, so good. Nothing's come up. Knock on wood. Let's hope nothing comes up. I'd like a clean management letter for once.
No.
Do you have any questions for me?
We've answered them all.
Thank you very much.
Very thorough. Thank you.
And, we appreciate it. See you next quarter.
Yeah.
I'll see you next week.
Yes, you will.
That's right.
Oh, that's right.
Okay, we're actually kind of reverting to our original schedule here. I apologize to the cemetery trustees. We now have a hearing for an early opening request for Tread LLC. If the secretary could please read the notice of the hearing.
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on October 20th, 2015. At 8 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on request for early opening at 5 a.m. for Tread LLC, 6 Linden Street. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the Town Manager's Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, and Thursdays from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and is attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on October 20th, 2015 to townmanager@ci.reading.ma.us.
Thank you. So we have Laura here tonight. Is Tiffany here? Yep, there she is. Okay, right there. Okay, what we did last time we met, we granted you folks a license through today for the 5 a.m. opening. We were going to review the situation. And if you'd like to
lead the discussion on what's transpired since.
Let me just Bob, you explain to the public what the board has in front of it. In tonight's packet in pages 4 and 5, Tiffany and Lori have outlined the steps they've taken in that period of time. It's quite extensive. And then 4 pages after that are letters or emails from abutters generally. And these are all the communication that we received, at least. I know some of the folks are here tonight.
So maybe I'll just do a quick 5-minute summary.
Sure. Okay.
So today marks our 80th day of being open. Mm-hmm. So it's been really wonderful. You know, every day more people have been coming in, and it's been really exciting for us. It's been 6 weeks since we started having 5:15 classes. I think since opening, we've recognized that sound was going to be kind of a big issue. I mean, we're in a standalone building, but we recognize that you know, there's neighbors that are close, and our activity is very high energy. And so as part of the initial investment in the building was a lot of soundproofing within it. And I think over time, you know, it's been great getting feedback from the neighbors, because it's not, sound is such a complicated thing. It's not about a single, like, you can hear it. There's vibrations and things at different levels. And so we've been getting, over time, lots of different feedback. We've been going into the neighbor's house almost on a weekly basis to get an understanding. We brought in sound engineers. We have a report from Cashins, and who's an environmental testing company. So we've spent a lot of time trying to understand a little bit more of the dynamics of what's been happening with the sound. So I think what we've heard from everybody is that we've gotten a lot better. Good. It's not perfect, but it's gotten a lot better, and we're going to continue. I mean, we're getting to the place where, like, there's actually specific songs that have a higher bass that we know not to play now, and that's the level that we're kind of getting to. We've set a specific set of rules, though, for what happens at 5 a.m. that are implemented going forward. And we kind of listed out what those were.
Yep.
There's certain instructors, because people's voices carry differently. And although when we came in last time, the microphones were an issue. We got a new mixer, so voices aren't an issue. But just to make sure, we have a certain set of instructors that are allowed to teach. Lori is not one of them. So we have a certain set of, and there's certain types of playlists that can play, and there's also certain types of classes. There's no kickboxing that can happen at 5 a.m. because that's a particularly high energy class. And so the feedback I've gotten from the 5 to 6, which I think is all we're covering tonight, has been from I think everybody universally that the 5 to 6, nobody's heard a peep between that hours. And those rules that we've instituted are for the long haul. That's how we're going to be operating our business. You know, I think that there's still work to be done on kind of the overall that we're continuing to work on. I mean, we've got sound assessments that say we're in, if you look at kind of the Boston tolerance and you look at kind of the state regulations, I know Reading has a different set of one, we're within the guidelines, but we can do better. We want to be good neighbors, and we want everybody to be happy, and we'll continue to work on that. But I think, and I'm going to stop talking in a second, that the 5 to 6 a.m., I think we have not heard any complaints at all, and that the rules that we've put in place for that has, over this test period of the last 6 weeks, has worked.
Very good. Let me first take questions from the board, then I'll take questions from the audience. John Arena.
In our prepared notes tonight, it says you're still waiting or expect to receive communication from 12 Linden Street. Has that been received at this point?
No.
Bob, have we received any for the town?
Okay.
Is anyone here tonight from 12 Linden?
We're here.
Oh, good.
I was going to send them a communication, and then I got the notice for the meeting, and I said, well, I'll just call the meeting.
You can answer if you want. Yeah, I'll take you out.
Yes. The 5 o'clock.
Just, if you would just state your name for the record.
Oh, I'm sorry. Karen German, 12 Linden Street. This is my husband, Manuel. Our daughter couldn't be here tonight, but she concurs with us. That's good news. I'm very happy to say that what they've done, their commendable efforts, has made a dramatic reduction in the noise. For us, it was the booms and the vibrating house. Not that it's, like she said, it's not perfect. Saturday and Sunday, there's nobody else, you know, in the neighborhood, no traffic, no trains, no trucks to kind of mix in with them and, you know, make them blend in, we'll say.
Sure.
But it's at tolerable levels. We're willing to cut them a little bit of slack. But we don't want them to think, oh, well, everything's okay. Let's, you know, crank it up. I'd like some assurances that that's not going to happen.
Well, this comes up every year, anyway.
But
it
the
does.
5 o'clock opening, yeah. You know, yeah. What tread? I don't hear a thing. I think I spoke to you, Kevin.
Yes. Yeah,
an occasional door slamming or somebody talking. Yesterday, I don't know what was going on, but it was in the parking lot or in front of their place. There was a lot of jibber jabber going on, but.
Bob, is there?
It's going to happen, you know.
Yeah.
I'm not going to go flying out my door with a stick and wax.
Please, we had a lot of locks in the room.
Yeah,
there.
No stick rule in this town.
I can only speak for 12 and 14, which is where we live. And if you were on Linden Street, Kevin, you could see that the side of our house is.
Is very visible to it.
A huge sounding board, and especially with that patio next door and
right.
front. I see no reason why they can't open at 5 o'clock or 4 o'clock or 3 o'clock, as long as we don't know they're there. You know, the noise starts like 7:15 with their tread and shred, you know. And I don't think it's ever going to be 100%, but I will say one thing, that they told me that the windows have been soundproofed. Maybe not enough, because I was opening the window at the top of my stairs a couple of weeks ago when it was warm, and I could hear the microphone clear as a bell. And I think it's coming right out.
And this is these later classes you're referencing, right? Later in the morning classes you're referencing?
Yeah, not 6:30
okay.
or something.
Well, that's when they let Laurie out.
The process. This license will go through December 31st. Now,
correct.
Is there a separate hearing for this, or is this renewed with en masse?
This will be renewed. I think it's going to be at your meeting on December 15th. Yeah. Let me look. Yes.
Is it along with other such licenses?
Yes. All early openings,
right,
for instance.
The normal renewal.
And the normal process is, if there are no complaints, there's no reason to have businesses in here. If there's a complaint, we ask the businesses to come in.
Right. That's how it will work. Thank you for that. Let's resume the board's questions. John first.
I've been down there twice at 5:30 in the morning, and it is quiet. I mean, if you stand outside.
Believe me, I was not inside. I'm not going in. But, I mean, you know, I just felt like it was important to, at least for me, to go in. And, you know, I've heard from a lot of people who are truly enjoying your business. And I think that you guys have worked very hard.
Yes.
And I'm thrilled that, you know, one of your neighbors acknowledges your effort. I think it's great that you guys have done that. So.
Kevin.
Yeah, I'd just like to commend both the owners and the neighbors for, you know, working together on this. I went down and toured the Tread LLC at 5:30 in the morning. Actually, Karen saved me from doing that because I called her first to see if, you know, how things were going. And she said, "Don't come down. There's no need. Everything's great." I said, "That's even better. You just saved me an hour's sleep." And yesterday morning, I was sick as a dog, so that was even better that I didn't have to go out. But the owners really have done a lot. I went down and toured both what they did when they bought the, or when they put the business in the place, expecting that we're going to be making some noise. And then what they did post our last meeting to ramp that up and to really try to dial it down, the vibration being one of the biggest things. I think they took their woofer, which is where you're getting all that bass from, and they cranked it to its lowest level possible. They insulated it, got up off the ground. They were showing all these things they did to it to try to stop the vibration from breaking the room and getting into the neighborhood. And it was great to talk to Karen over the weekend to hear that, you know, the fact that that had happened, because Karen's side of her house is a direct, you know, there's no break between the business and her, so you can see where that would have been problematic to continue. So I just want to commend both of you for really a lot of hard work, I know, on both parts, and putting up with the trial and error period that we put you through from the last meeting that we had with you here. So that's good news to hear that you came to come back and tell us tonight that that everything looks good for this business to open up at an important time, which I know is. A lot of other businesses are open at that time. Well, they potentially could have lost customers too. So I think that's a good win-win all around for everybody.
Anything more from the board? No.
Do we need a motion to extend this?
Yeah.
Is there one?
Not yet. We haven't heard from the public.
No, I'm wondering. I'm asking out loud if.
Yeah, there's a
correct.
If there's a requirement to extend this from
hearing, yes.
today's date, which I think is where we shut it off, and then go forward.
This will take them through December 31st, first midnight.
Okay.
That's what will happen. Anything more from the board at this point? Okay, throw it open again. Name and address if you wish to speak.
Wow.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, is there any other comment before we close the hearing? Thank you, everybody, for coming out tonight.
Mr. Secretary.
Move to close the hearing for the early opening for Tread LLC at 6 Linden Street.
Second.
Okay, show of hands, supporting the closing? 5-0, the hearing is closed. Is there a motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the license to operate a retail business between the hours of midnight and 6 a.m. pursuant to Section 7.1 of the Reading General Bylaw, and further pursuant to Section 3.9 of the Board of Selectmen Policies, the Tread LLC, 6 Linden Street, subject to the following conditions. One, this license is for approval pursuant to the Board of Selectmen Regulation 3.9 to open for business not earlier than 5 a.m. on Monday through Friday, and not earlier than 6 a.m. on Saturday, Sunday, and holidays. Two, this approval expires at midnight, December 31st, 2015. And three, all signs shall conform to the zoning bylaws of the town of Reading. In granting this license, the board finds that in accordance with Section 5.10.4 of general bylaws, it is in the interest of the public health, safety, and welfare, or that public necessity or convenience will be served by permitting such operation, and there is no detrimental effect of such operation on the town or the immediately abutting neighbors.
Okay. Okay. Is there further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion? Opposed? The vote is 5-0. Your approval is granted.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Good job.
And again, this will come up on a normal basis unless we get other complaints, so you don't have to worry about coming to the hearing in November, December, whenever we do the renewals.
Awesome.
Thank you, everybody, for coming
in. Thanks,
everybody.
Stay in bed at
5
o'clock.
See you
at
5 a.m.
Yeah. Not a chance.
Okay. Okay, we have the Cemetery Board of Trustees here. Bill, would you like to introduce the trustees to the board? Okay. Let's hold on. Yeah. All right, we're going to take a 2-minute break. Okay, we will re-adjourn the meeting here. Reconvene the meeting. We won't adjourn it yet. Okay. So, Janet Melkonian, is that you?
Maronian,
I'm sorry. Okay.
Not selling cars.
Ron's school license.
Hi, Ron. Welcome.
And Elise Serenio.
Thank you for coming in tonight. I thought it was good to get the two boards together because we have Article 13 coming up on the subsequent town meeting. Bill and I have had a number of sidebars on this, but I thought board to board it would be a good thing to talk. Can you folks give us your path forward, how you're going to proceed on 13 at this point? I know you've had some discussions with the Permanent Building Committee. What would you say is the path forward for you at this point? Are you still going for the $2 million, or are you going to go for some other approach?
At this stage of the game, I truly can't answer, Dan. I think, given that you people are voting against it, the FinCom is not for, I guess our path is to go with the building committee.
Okay.
Keeping in mind, though, that the building committee, according to the bylaw, is $2 million or more, and we're asking for $2 million less. So, but as long as it gets us to the path of a new building, we don't care how we get there.
So it would be your plan to work with the PBC? Would you be seeking design funds, potentially?
Yeah.
Okay.
And as you know, we offered 100,000 towards the building, I think.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Although we haven't met formally to take a vote on that, we could probably come up with some of the funding for the design.
Yeah, it's important that you vote on whatever outcome you come up with before a town meeting, I think.
Yeah. Understanding, though, that would be the total amount of funds, because we can't take too much out of the sale of lots.
Right.
That's used for expansion and other stuff.
Okay, Barry.
I mean, I think that for all intents and purposes, you're the, I'm not going to say guinea pig, but you're the prototype project for what was envisioned by many for what a building committee should be used for. I mean, so, you know, you've been talking about the project for a long time. The building committee just started, so in fairness to them, obviously, they're catching up. But really, when a lot of us thought about, including you, Bill, having a permanent building committee, you know, having, you know, this was exactly the type of project that you know, would go through that. And I think in conversations with a lot of people, I don't think it's outrageous to think that down the road, shortly, you know, the building committee might on its own sort of promote or propose that we have some type of a revolving fund or a permanent fund so that when projects come, that we've set, that we basically as a group have set aside some money that says, you know what, we value good data mm-hmm. and good information, and it's going to cost money to get some of this good data, so that maybe we set up aside, you know, some type of a fund where the permanent, you know, where we vote that in, and when a project comes up, you know, there's money there. We have, you know, a consultant maybe on speed dial to kind of run some things, and you know, so that we can get information faster, so that we don't have to go back to town meeting 3 and 4 times to do this. So
that's a good thought for the PBC to deliberate on, because they're evolving their own rules right. of right. engagement, I think. So that's,
and so
that's
it's
a good
well,
thought.
It's nice of you yeah. to kind of, you know, yeah. sort of propose money. I think that in, at least in my, you know, in my view, you know, that's something that we should be thinking about town-wide in terms of yeah. how are we going to support the study of potential projects to see whether they're viable, and not necessarily ask a sponsoring group to maybe spend all that money, but that there's value in the town.
Well,
saying,
correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe any project under the aegis of the PBC is the money is spent under the care, custody, and control of the permanent building committee. Is that correct or not?
Yes.
It's not correct.
All leaves lead roads lead to Rome.
Because yeah. Bob corrected my article in the warrant.
So what's the answer? Yes or no?
It's under the authority of the town manager, but obviously
oh, okay.
the PBC
yeah.
is highly
yeah.
involved. Barry's idea is a really good one, but mm-hmm. The issue is town meeting is always the authority that has to approve spending. Period.
Right.
Even if it's in a revolving fund, mm-hmm. So we can put money in there as sort of a savings yeah. account. But to get it out, we have to ask town meeting. So, you know, it could be a new practice that we regularly in an annual budget do that.
Yeah.
100,000, 200,000, whatever a good number is, just so it's available just in case.
It could be turned back as
it right. could be.
As we turn back.
And we can also, another way to do it is to give FinCom a little larger reserve fund so that they could serve that purpose.
That's true.
In
well.
Between
yep.
town
yep.
meetings. So there's plenty of ways to do it, and I agree with you, town meeting was loud and clear about come to us with better upfront data, if you will, for any of these projects and really think it through upfront. We'd much rather not save a couple bucks upfront. And I think we all hear that loud and clear.
Yeah, Bill.
Dan, one thing I would caution, when I shudder when I hear the word consultant, they tell you what you want to hear. And the best example I can suggest that is when we built the prison fire station. We hired George Paul to tell us what we already knew, that that's where the fire station should be. And we already had the manning that he suggested. So. Mm. And there's enough data out there on the cemetery building. If you want it, I'll bring you down a whole sack of it. And there's enough history and the need of it. I don't want to go back and reinvent the wheel.
No, I think if all that is put in the hands of the PBC, they'll make...
They have most
they
of
have
it.
It.
Yeah. They'll make a smart decision about yeah. that, I think. Yeah. You got some really high-caliber people. For those who haven't met this group, I'm very impressed.
Yeah.
The little I've seen of them, they're
and that's part of the reason I think yeah. I can suggest, you know, we would go along with the caliber. I can't speak for the rest of the board. We haven't had a meeting to discuss it, but I think I've been the lead person.
Are you guys in session right now?
What's that?
Are you called to order or not?
You're going to call us to order?
Oh.
No, it wasn't.
Okay. Yeah.
You're not posted?
Oh, just to make it
yeah, you're, oh, posted. Right. You're posted.
I think you're posted.
Yeah, you should call yourselves to order.
Yeah, we have a quorum.
Then you can talk amongst
yeah.
yourselves.
Yeah.
Legally.
She's a chairman.
Called himself
okay.
to order 10 minutes ago, as I remember.
That's
as
I remember.
That's cool. I agree. Okay.
Thought I heard that, Jan.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Way back.
John Arena.
Okay.
Yes.
Phil, I heard you in your opening remarks. I heard a reservation that the board, our board, had
had voted not to support, and FinCom had taken a similar position. I wouldn't take the position of the board as anything but wanting to be the best stewards of the funding and apply the best governance. As accurate and as proportional as that styrofoam model you brought in was, there's no way we can tell with any sense of certainty to the level the town's going to demand what the cost of the project will be and what the options are. And I very much appreciate all the background work that's been done. I don't think any of that's going to go to waste.
No.
This is all positive. I know it feels like a step backwards, but I think it's actually a step forward, that it's just very measured and very predictable, but you're going to get far more data and far more data that town meeting will accept on face value.
Well, in the warrant, there are two comparisons that I've gone to, Medfield and Wakefield on building, recent buildings. So
Those are helpful.
Yes.
Our conditions may be different.
Good solid figures.
Yep. In fact, one of the gentlemen on the permit building committee, he was built, I think, three DPWs, said he doesn't know of one that co-locates the cemetery garage with the DPW. So that's in defense of your plan. So you've been affirmed in that sense, I think. Just one note on the appointment of the temporary members. I was all ready to ask Alan, when the appointing committee sat down, to appoint the two of you. But then Bob ran into town council that very evening, and he said, slow down. We can't do that till there's a valid project. In other words, a vote of town meeting, and whereupon that will happen immediately. So we have to hold back on that, according to town council.
And so we're a month out from that?
Yeah.
Roughly.
So. Yeah. So this will come up, the 9th through the 12th.
A month in government speak is like a nanosecond.
Oh, that's like tomorrow.
Yeah.
It's a blink of an eye.
Right. So Bob?
Yeah. A couple things. First, should you decide, and I'll try to go to, the building committee's meeting Thursday.
Yeah, we're going to be there.
Okay, should they suggest we need funding, I will suggest it come up under both Articles 3 and 5. First put it in the capital plan and then ask for whatever the funding is. Mm-hmm. We'll put it in the facilities department. And another comment, just so everyone hears it. I can't remember if it was an instructional motion, but it was pretty clear from town meeting that one of the voices was, please take care of the building, have the facilities department take it over.
Right.
As Bill pointed out at the FinCom meeting, when someone asked what's the operating cost of the building from a maintenance standpoint, he said, well, historically it's zero, and he's right. I'm happy to say the rearranged and restructured facilities department has been over there and made a lot of improvements.
Yep.
And I'm sure Bill knows it, and the staff is very happy.
I check it daily.
Yeah, because they have truly been ignored and tried to be on their own for years.
Yeah. He owns 15 lots.
He should not be spending that much time in the cemetery.
John, sometime I will be spending forever there.
Well, I don't.
Plenty of time.
It's got the best foliage in town, I'll tell you
it
that.
It does have the best foliage.
Yeah, so I don't blame you.
It's good. I love going down that.
Any further questions? Do you have any questions of us? I think we're on the same path here.
I think I've spoken enough.
Okay. Anybody?
I think you guys know where I stand on it. I don't know how the rest can be.
Okay.
Well, we're here to support Bill, or I am anyway. So, and I'm looking forward to meeting with the building committee, and we're hoping to get as many of them as possible on the same date to do a little field visit.
Yep.
We had originally scheduled the 24th, but I guess they're having trouble trying to get people.
Yeah, they're busy guys.
Yeah, so we're going to suggest, sadly, the 31st,
yeah,
which happens to be Halloween. We'll start, well, maybe we can
it's
do
a great time
that's
to be in
a great
cemetery.
Time to be in a cemetery, right?
Yeah. Do it
side note
right around
that,
6:30.
There are actually communities that hold spooky nights in the cemetery on Halloween, believe it or not. And there's actually fundraisers in Halloween. We want to take the tomb and make a bar out of it, but that's enough.
Steve and I are working on that.
The secretary will strike that from.
No, we really would like them to be able to get together with us and do a site visit before at least the snowfall.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. The 31st, and the other thing is too, we want them to go to Forest Glen to see that site.
Yeah.
And it
yeah.
will be helpful in. Either Bob or I will. I'm going to talk to engineering if they get us kind of yellow taped up where the yellow caution tape where the area might be. I know it.
Sure.
I think most of the members know it, but they
on the study
yeah.
where they have placed
yeah.
it.
Yeah, visuals are always good.
Yeah. yellow tape, and then all the neighbors would get them wrong, but that's all right.
By Halloween.
All the external neighbors, the internal neighbors don't bother us. We don't hear from
too much.
Them. We don't hear from them at all, but we're here to speak for them.
So many places I can go with that.
And none of them are good.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Glad we're moving forward together. I'm happy to see it, and we should get together at least twice a year, I would say, you know.
It's your call. We answer to you, I think. And yes. After N114.
Yes.
Which gives us some certain times authority more than you right. have.
And so we're always happy to see your smiling faces here. We'll set you up on a regular basis.
We also, one little side note to it, too. That when a lot is sold, we have the obligation to make sure that money's used wisely.
Yep.
And that's one of the reasons that we don't feel that combining with DPW is and the extra time mm-hmm. in transportation is using the money wisely. If it's in one of the cemeteries, and I'm going to keep harping this until either I die or you get the building, one or the other. And,
leave a recording.
Yeah. I don't care about it. But no, we are incumbent to make sure that the money is spent properly. We do a hell of a good job with the guidance of Bob Keating. I have to tell you, I hope we're able to replace him in 2 years with somebody as good.
Yeah,
he's very, very knowledgeable in the business.
All right. So, well, thanks for your good work, folks. And,
foreman will be leaving in 2 years, too, so there's going to be some educational.
You got some institutional memory to replace there.
Oh, yeah. And, that's a reason, another reason we bugged at the idea of outsourcing. And the only cemetery that can find was Medford.
Right.
But they have 80 acres and it's all flat. There's no hills and curves like, and you know, again, that's it. So, but if any of the rest of them have anything to say, I think I've said my piece tonight.
Great.
I guess I would just say thanks to everybody for their patience moving forward. I've been on the cemetery board since 2007, and we've been talking about this building since then. So I'm hoping to stay running another 25 years and see this completed.
She's very knowledgeable in cemeteries. She worked at Forest Hill Cemetery for a good many years. And she's an expert on marble headstones, if anybody wants to know marble.
Oh. I know it's marble headstones.
You are the only entity on the agenda of the Permanent Building Committee, so you should receive their full attention.
Okay. Yeah. Can I just make a suggestion to you, because I've heard this from maybe a half a dozen people over the last 2 years, to consider a columbarium somewhere, you know, within the confines of what we have.
Can you define that, John?
Well, columbarium, for example, is a place. It creates a niche where an urn could go. Yeah.
It's different from a mausoleum in that you don't get graves.
Yeah. Right? You know, I mean, it's it literally has been brought to my attention on half a dozen occasions over the course of the last 2 years since I've been selecting.
One of the things that Leach did suggest, and it goes along with somewhat that John. Because of the terrain up there, I think you could probably make a nice wall with the and the other thing she suggested.
You mean Forest Glen, where there's
at the present site of Laura Hill, if the building's taken down, I think your idea is great, John. And she's also suggested a scattering garden.
Yes, where, Bill's talked about that to me.
Yeah, yeah. And I think that's a great. Well, right now there is not a need for that, John. There's more than enough space for urns to be buried. Mm.
I understand that, but I also understand that we've been in business here for almost 400 years.
Well, we're going to be
the expectation is that there's going to be another 400 years, and so chess is always better than checkers when it comes to these things.
And one of my grandsons is working, he works as a civil engineer for the town of Burlington, and they're presently doing it over there, but they're running into problems with the planning board and everybody else in a gas line that runs through the middle of the cemetery. So. Yeah.
I mentioned it to you because that's good. Comes up.
The board has been, you know, thinking the alternatives. Right now, our present agenda is getting the building.
I understand that.
Yeah. And our meetings are always open, and anybody wants to come in, we won't bury him for coming.
You meet earlier in the day, right, like 6 o'clock?
6 o'clock. The basic reason for that. A number of years ago, Bob was staying till 7 o'clock at night, and then he had his heart attack, and we said, hey, you know what, he's got an hour ride to Canton from here.
Sure.
We want to get him out of the building, you know, and home.
Let's consider it.
In time, so we can get up and come back to work the next morning.
Exactly. At 6 a.m.
Yes.
All right.
He's here generally 7 o'clock. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming in.
See you at town meeting.
Yep.
Okay. And the PVC. All right. Moving on to our last item here, the preview of the financial forum. Bob has prepared some material here. Bob, do you want to review that?
Yeah, I'll just go real quick. This is a summary we gave to FinCom last week. We did get some slight changes today from DOR. So first of all, I'm happy to tell you that new growth was over 900,000. We had budgeted 500,000, and in the town meeting warrant, we knew it would be at least 700,000, but it's another couple hundred thousand. Don't know, just got the number 912,000. You know, our assessor had kind of hinted that it would be in the ballpark of that, but couldn't really say it.
What's our run rate?
This is the highest one in at the 5 years I look back. It was in the 560, 640, 700 area. Back at the landfill days, it did go over a billion for 1 or 2 years. When Sharon was going over revenues, also last week, our permits department, our building department, is really busy.
Really?
Yeah.
Must be the stock market people.
Yeah, you know, it's a combination of businesses, and a lot of it's residential. Look at all the improvements going on around town. And again, this is through last January. This isn't anything you've seen since the spring.
I rode my bike, my real bike, not the tread bike, through town one day last week. I was out for about half an hour. I counted 24 trucks, and I'm not talking about landscaping trucks. I went through all, just, you know, a roofer, a remodeler, HVAC.
Money on
24
the land.
In a period of about a half an hour, and I went all over different parts of town. So, you know, you can probably attest to people keeping their houses and adding on, right?
Yep.
So, it's booming.
When that happens, to that, to Barry's point, that triggers, does that trigger a revaluation, or is it just get an add-on to the incremental?
It's new growth. You know, it could be $20,000 in your kitchen, which isn't going to be much, or it could be a knocked an old house down and built a whole new one, which is going to be more.
It allows you to raise 2.5% of that amount.
Plus the new growth.
Yeah, so anything you do to your house that changes it is new growth. Obviously, if it's a small thing, we don't really bother. But if it's an addition or something, yeah, absolutely would bother.
Raises your levy limit by that amount automatically.
Yeah. Bob, so the 900,000 goes into the base for next year, which is the important part.
So we're starting at 5E3. If you could just sort of point to the cells you're talking about, that would be really helpful.
These aren't going to match exactly because I updated based on today, but if you look at this slide behind me, this hasn't changed. We're still proposing that there's another $1 million or so in revenues, and we're proposing to spend $1 million. What has changed is the free cash is now down to less than half of that, so we're asking for less than 500,000 of free cash from town meeting. And optically, that looks nice because we're spending free cash on capital. It's a one-time use of cash, it's a one-time use of capital. So that's what we always strive for, and that was kind of the goal here. The other $500,000 of expenses that we're incurring is generally sustainable expenses, not completely, but close. And it's all sustainable revenue, so it's a good match, is all I'm saying. What you're going to see next week as an update, and this, you can see we go out a few years.
What page are we on, 5E4 now?
Yeah, this is both Dan's and John's earlier comments about revenue long term. You know, we're looking at less than 3%. That's just what Prop 2.5 says. Now, we happen to get good new growth number or really good state aid, then that number might go as high as 3.5 if you really want to go crazy. Mm. But there's very little chance of that. And just back here, you see a higher number. That's because of the debt exclusion for the library. So that's paying a debt service cost. It's not real revenue that's available. Otherwise, all these revenue figures you see historically are right around 3%. And in some years, a few years ago, it was lower than 2%. Which is tough, but you basically have, let's just say, 3% of revenue to work with in any given year. One of the biggest challenges is this line here called accommodated costs, and of all of the items in there, particularly it's health insurance as an employee benefit. As a community, we spend far less dollars on health insurance than most communities do because our employees pay a good percent. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't matter. It's still a huge percent of the budget, and when it goes up by 10%, yes, and your revenues are going up by 3%, guess what? That's a problem.
It skews the equation.
So the Stoneham Board of Selectmen did a survey 3 or 4 years ago. It was really interesting. The range was between 8% and 20% of people's budgets were spent on health insurance, if you can believe that, for a municipality. And we were around 9% at the time. So we were at the good side of that, if you will. And 20% was just unbelievable. You know, again, when you get a double digit increase, whether it's 10% or 20%, you're basically taking, in some cases, more than all the new revenue that's coming in the door. So not only can you not afford inflation of services, you actually have to reduce the money you spent. So in a nutshell, to be real simple, if things like health insurance had a Prop 2.5 on it, we'd be much better off.
Right.
You know, we just would.
Yeah, none of our costs are under Prop 2.5.
And as well as we've done very well with those costs.
We have done very well. Our health insurance premiums have... you know, historically been as good as any community around here. We were running at less than 3% for 7 or 8 years and then had a bad year finally. It caught up to us, not surprisingly.
But think about that. I mean, we're, you know, we applaud ourselves for being able to run at this unbelievable 3% growth rate.
Yeah.
Which we are going backwards when that happens.
Yeah.
Because our, you know, our revenue stream is only growing by 2.5, and that's
exactly right.
Plus new growth. Yeah.
Yeah.
But the good news, bad news, it's forcing you to be lean and agile, and we've done some really clever things. I think, you know, we may be running out of runway on that one.
Yeah.
That's well put, John.
I think that's an understatement.
Yeah. Bob, one point that this always occurs to me this time of the year. When I first joined the board, when I first joined town meeting, I was amazed, coming from the business world, at how much of the budget is wage and salary related. And, you know, your typical, those in manufacturing or those in an office somewhere, you might have 30-40% of revenues be tied on the expense side to wage and salary, and benefits might be another 10%. I don't think people at home realize how much of the budget is driven by just wage and salary expense and how inflexible that is. You basically have people moving along in steps and...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the growth of it's inflexible.
It's not like you can save by... We don't have any production we can ramp up or expenses we can ramp down. It's all wage-based.
We don't make anything.
Because the average guy at home doesn't...
Tax rates.
That's an aha moment.
Progress is our most important product.
Right. So that's why it's all wages.
John, you're right. The schools are heavy on wages. Public safety is enormously lopsided on wages. Their expense budget is something like $200,000 combined out of a $10 million budget. So it's all wages. And you're right, in the private sector, one of the FinCom members is a treasurer at a really well-known company, and we had a really interesting discussion of the difference between corporate finance and municipal finance. Mm. And his eyes were bugging out by the end of the discussion with me. He said, well, what happens if you're starting to have a bad year and you're losing revenue and you need to close that gap? Can't you just sell debt? I was like, no, you can't do that. You have to have a balanced budget. You do.
Right.
So, you know, the tools we have available to a good finance person quickly... make them realize, no wonder this is so difficult.
Well, you know, government accounting and, you know, the movement of money and how it is allocated and what you can do to be nimble doesn't exist, you know, on a government-driven
spreadsheet. And, you know, I guess the theory is the taxpayers are very well protected. Yeah. You can't get that creative with the money.
And, you know, that's not a bad thing, but they need to understand.
That's
I think, John, you've made an exceptionally good point, is that most people, and I'm not questioning their intellect or intelligence, it's just not something you don't intuitively think about the fact that you've got a revenue system that has been intentionally designed to fail.
Yeah.
I mean, that is the way it's built. And, you know, the first time I looked at this in earnest myself was probably about 3 years ago. And I just went, I've spent my life, you know, with a corporate spreadsheet in my head. And I looked at these things and I just went, you got to be kidding me. I mean, this thing is designed to splinter. Over time. I mean, not like tomorrow, but so this is part of the reason, too. The very things you're talking about,
connect to this MAPC discussion.
Right.
You know, I mean, we can't, I don't think we can avoid an upcoming override, but we may be able, if we do this wisely, if we have economic development in this town done correctly, we may be able to push the next operating override out 20 years, you know, instead of 10.
There are some towns who don't do, who have, Wakefield's never done an override, right? But they have that commercial kind of tax base that.
That makes a big difference.
Makes a big difference.
So, I, the way I look at this, you know, it's just sort of, you know, it's our responsibility as sort of the leaders of the town. That if this board is going to have a legacy, I think we should think about it in terms of what are the things that we can do that will put this town on firm financial footing for the next 15 to 20 years.
Right.
And it's tied to managing our expenses, thinking about the services that we want to do, thoughtfully developing the last bits of development parcels that we can that engage
developing toward, and redeveloping
toward growth.
Right.
And looking at potentially, hopefully, maybe the last operational override.
It would be
that we
fondly hoped.
But the thing is that I think it's up to us to talk about these things not sort of separately, but sort of as an overall package.
Yeah.
And we go to the voters and we say, this is our goal. Our goal is to not have to come back here
for
in 5 years.
Quite a while.
Yep. But this is what you say we want to have the services. This is what's in the pot right now. This is how we can make the pot bigger. And we need a little bit of help.
Now,
I think if it's talked about in that rubric, I think it makes.
I do think the one caveat that we have to work hard on if we're going to follow this path, which I happen to endorse, Larry, I think you described a wise movement down a path a certain way. We have to work diligently, turn every rock over to make sure that we can look to certain protected classes of our citizens who can ill afford, you know, a 10% increase in their taxes.
And
so we need to be able to look at all the possible facilities that will blunt that for those people who are at greatest risk.
And I would include in that list of, you know, arrows that we have, the idea of tax classification to some maybe minor degree.
Yeah, I mean,
it has to be on the table.
We looked at that, what was it, 7, 8, 9, 10 years ago. There was a commission that looked at, actually recommended a tax classification that current board, the current board actually voted down.
The prior boards of selectmen have been very reluctant to do it, but I think this board is going to look at it with some fresh eyes.
I think that's definitely on the table. You look at the growth. I mean, the argument that was used then on classification, well, two things. Mm-hmm. One, it doesn't make the pie any bigger.
No, it doesn't.
It just makes the business owners pay more. And we're at a time when we can't hurt the business owners. But if you look at people beating themselves down to try to come into this town, I think it's a tool that needs to get looked at again. And maybe, I don't know if it makes sense, you know, do we reconvene that working group again? It was, 8 years ago? 10 years ago?
We can avail ourselves.
I mean, just to kind of look at that again and just see, you know, how are we, you know, for example, how are we assessing commercial properties in town vis-a-vis how other...
Oh, the long-term. Because we have to decide this in 2 weeks. So.
Right, but I'm saying, maybe we, you know, we just say, like, for next year, we're going to look at something like that.
You guys are down the road on implementation. My only point is, the average guy at home, we got to figure out a different vocabulary, because the one we're using makes sense to us.
I know.
But I think the minute you get out of those 192 people in town meeting, the eyes glaze over.
Well, how do you want to conduct tonight's discussion?
My only point is, there's an aha moment. It was an event for me a few years ago, and everyone I talked to, the eyes glaze over, and it's a real important moment that they understand that municipal government is largely driven by wage. And you either reduce the headcount, or you find a way to fund the staff, or you deal with attrition and inability to hire when you do get a gap, which is where we are. That's the symptom of the onset of the crisis, is you can't refill folks who retire, and you can't bring in new talent.
Now, in terms of saying we want to fix this thing for 15 years, we're going to have some constraints on that. Let me give you some of the statistics in that vote thing that we took at town meeting. What would you like to see? Less services, 9%. Same amount of services, 54%. That, by and large, was the vote. And then when...
And more services, how many?
More services was...
37.
26%, I don't know yet, 10%.
So you have 80% of the assembled people who suggested that you either flatline or increase services.
Correct.
And we already know by just running, you know, you run a spreadsheet out 5 years.
Yeah.
You can't fund it.
Right.
Unless you get lucky and one-time things that kind of help you along, and that, which is what we've been doing. And, you know, but at a certain point,
it's not a good recipe.
Here's a more important one. Question six. The annual property tax bill for the average value home in Reading is currently about $6,500. What is the maximum increase in this annual property tax bill that you would support in a Proposition 2.5 operational override? So these are percent choices for increase. None, 19%, so no override. 2.5%, 24% voted for that. Plus 5%, 35% voted for that. Plus 7.5%, I should read the numbers that go with each one on the average tax bill. So if you raise taxes 2.5%, that's 160 on the average home. 24% of the folks voted for that at town meeting. If you raise them 5% or 325 per home, 35% selected that. If you raise them 7.5% or $490, 15%, so it's starting to decline again. And if you raise them 10% or 650, only 5%. More than 10%, only 1%. So to raise that much. So
you only had only 20% of the assembled people who felt that some change shouldn't happen. You only had 19% of 19 out of 100 people said
80% of the people said we need to do something.
We need to do something
and
pick the number.
And also 80% roughly 80% said 5% or less.
How would the board feel about posting that same survey on the website? We had at most, I think, 158 respondents out of.
Can we do that?
Why wouldn't we, instead of looking at just elected officials, why don't we ask the community what they think? The very same question, pose the same.
I'm all for that.
Just curiosity, where does it end up?
I think it's worth discussing next week before we just throw out a survey.
Agreed.
But I think that should give us some pause if this is indicative of the community. This might be more generous than the general community would vote, I would argue.
It's only those
actually,
in the room.
It's what? It's almost now 6 months old?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you know, and if anything, people might think, it might change.
Hard to say. We need to ask them.
Is there a way that we can, you know, in regards to that, I know we'll discuss it more, but I'd actually be interested to drill down that even further. So that 19% that said none, there'd be an automatic follow-up question.
What do you want to cut?
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, no, seriously. You know, interesting. We'd like to do that as well. What would you like to cut?
Selecting salaries.
I think John is really on to something when he talks about the aha moment. I think that if you had a simple common sense discussion with those 19%.
Yeah.
Maybe half of them are going to just fundamentally be against any more taxes. It's America. You can think what you'd like, and that's fine. But I think the aha moment that you're talking about, John, would happen with a lot of people if we do the right job. And you know, you're on the right track here with a spreadsheet like this.
But you need something simpler. You need to get the concept across without the numbers.
Yeah.
Most people aren't going to understand that. We might because we stare at it regularly, and some of us are in this business. The average guy in the street isn't going to get it.
Yeah.
And that's the heart and mind you're trying to change.
And the average person on a fixed income in this town is going to say, "How am I going to afford this?"
Well,
this is my point about the protected.
Right. My property taxes are $6,000 a year. My house is paid up, but that is my direct. Yeah. That's the biggest increase.
They're right.
I think as we talk about this, what we have to avoid, and it's going to be hard to do, is sort of the kind of dynamic that happens between newer residents and residents that have been here for a long time, whose kids have maybe graduated from the schools. And you have kind of a newcomer versus, you know, folks who've been here longer.
You're not going to stop that.
Well, that's there.
No,
that's
but I think there, but I think that you know, in talking about going to the voters and asking for more money, we have to also be very, very careful how we craft what are the new things that we're going to have. And so maybe we're going to add services for senior folks. Right, help them stay in the houses better, or more increased services, than maybe than we would have thought of before. So it's the composition of what we're adding, I think, is important.
But you're
the idea to create a coalition of people who basically, I mean, everybody's going to agree, but a coalition of people who say, yes, we need to do that, and here's where it's going to go to, and here's what we think is important. And you just don't include folks who care about schools.
I wasn't really commenting on any of that.
No, but I think that that's as a strategy that, you know, how to create the largest coalition of folks who will be able to go out and talk to the neighbors in support of this.
Well, as much as some people may want to support something, they just simply can't afford. If there's a straight increase of 10% of the taxes, they don't have a lot of
recourse. So maybe the number's not 10. Maybe, you know, maybe
there may be means of lessening.
Something, right. I mean, that's all kind of what you're asking.
And that might involve classification considerations.
Bob, do you have a comment?
Yeah.
Yeah, the other aha moment I know that has happened for a lot of people that have talked to me, at least, is they start listing all the communities they want to live in, and they live in Reading. They move to Reading. I guarantee you the ones they want to live in did not have an override in the last 10 years, period. Mm-hmm. You know, you're right. Some communities, especially cities, don't do it. Places with a lot of commercial don't do it. Some do it almost every year. And that's the communities that Reading's being compared to, whether
Chinese
we like it or not.
Menu of things. I want to vote for this, but not
fire
that.
Truck.
That has pros and cons, definitely.
Yeah,
so,
which is,
you know,
not the way we should go.
I'm not in charge of who moves to Reading, but I can tell you what they want, which is a lot of things. Yeah. And we don't have to give them everything they
want. They don't
want
less than we're doing today.
But we don't have to give them everything they want. But if we want to give it to them, we need more sources of revenue.
Here's another angle. We've talked about this, Bob. In terms of limiting our staff demand and staff retention, you know, hopefully increasing that, I think we have to be better about managing the demand of volunteer boards on our staff. Maybe there's some way to allocate that with time.
Well, I think that one of the ways to do that, Dan, you know, this was something that you suggested, and I think earlier, I mean, I'm talking about several months ago, and I think we've just gotten away a little bit, and that is all the boards, commissions, and committees that are advisory to us and that we appoint, I think that we need to work with them off an agenda, you know, at least a, you know, maybe chair, vice chair of all of those groups to help them better understand, you know, how staff gets utilized. Because you're right.
That's a great
topic
for that meeting.
People abuse.
It's a little strong word, but I know.
No, they abuse the good, not abuse the staff, but they abuse the good nature.
Yeah.
And they overuse the time. And now that, you know, there's a lot of things that can extrapolate out of that. Employee retention, you know, reputation about, you know, attraction, and, you know, just generally speaking, effectiveness.
Just one example, I think our town engineer, as you said, attends most CPDC meetings. That isn't true in all communities. They may communicate more by memo,
right?
And that could be a consideration in the future.
Back on the chart.
No, I don't really have a lot more to say other than next year, if you go back historically in the fall, next year looks slightly better than it has for the last 4 or 5 years, back to what it used to look like much more often. We're looking at a 3% increase right now.
To the 17?
Yeah, in FY17. That does not include some school updates that are needed for energy costs. I'm not sure it'll stay at 3, but it'll be close. That also assumes we're using $2 million in free cash, which FinCom has as its high watermark historically, never more than 2. It used to be 1.5.
Right.
Seeing us, you know, regenerate as Sharon has described, I think they're willing to do 1.5 and 2. And
what's that budget do about filling? What's that budget do about filling vacant positions or positions that we've longed for?
It's a false economy.
We can't do the latter.
What's the basis of?
We're still longing for positions.
Well, you basically did the 3-year look at it.
3% does not fund the current staffing.
Okay.
Probably.
That's a very definitive answer.
Yeah. Now, the way it does fund it is we find expenses we can cut, and we don't hit the personnel side. As you pointed out, though, that's not easy to do in either school or town. It's a little easier because of, you know, we do have some expenses in public works. And, you know, if FinCom really wants to go down the road of doing less capital, it's possible.
You're at 4.5 now, right?
4.75, I think. I think they went down a quarter. But we're doing $500,000 in November, so that brings us 7 or 8%.
Yeah.
So we're easily doing what we should be doing.
Yeah.
You know, there's some question as to, I like the policy of 5%. I always have.
We never would have gotten to the
if we hadn't had that policy,
because
when I was on FinCom, it never happened.
Yeah, but you've caught up now. So,
but you are caught up now, mm-hmm. and to the extent that you see things like money coming in November and you can spend it on a one-time thing, that's good.
That's fair.
Do you really want to tie up all your operating budget on capital? It's a tough question, because historically the answer has been, well, we have to because we did such a lousy job. So you want to be real careful about that. But, you know, for a couple hundred thousand here or there.
So what, yeah, okay. what would the additional amount to the operating budget be if it went from 5 to 4?
If it,
800,000. Right?
It's a little hard to know sometimes.
I think it's a few hundred thousand for sure.
Mm. And that could be sustainable.
4% probably doesn't fund capital in the long run. It depends what else you mean to do. If you mean to start paying for cemetery garages, DPW garages, whatever other facilities you mean inside the tax levy, it's not going to do it.
It's not growth.
But you're going to have a reverse effect if your diminishment of capital expenses causes things to break down and increase
Absolutely.
Your operating costs.
Absolutely.
Probably yeah, enough to recapitalize what you own, but you can't grow the capital
yeah.
base.
You know, another reason we can take a break, which I suggested last year, is because of all the grant and state money coming in to do roads.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we just don't have the bandwidth to do yeah. anymore, so yeah. we can sort of step aside for 2 years. But these are all temporary things.
Well, maybe you reduce it for a period of time, and then some of these, maybe these development projects will kick in 4 or 5 years, and then that'll increase the growth,
yeah.
and then maybe then you can then add back to
that. We need to know what that's going to be.
I do think, though, that those development projects are really they're the thing that can put off the next
well,
not necessarily solve the problem with this one.
Are we doing real right. dollar projections on that, Bob, on our expected growth?
No.
That's what we should
we don't,
be
We
doing.
Don't know what it looks like, though.
Well, see, there's some other things that I don't know.
We have to do something.
Yeah. We can do it. We're not doing it yet.
Could have a budget for it, yeah.
You but know, last night, Jay and I sat and listened to a very well-informed Arcasa presentation. And I thought that I thought it told us a lot of things that are somewhat encouraging, the information created other challenges that we hadn't thought about 10 years ago when Arcasa started. But one of the things that we haven't considered here is how much of the funding of that program has been a result of spectacular grant writing, and how long does that last?
We're not eligible anymore.
So,
we broke the mold.
And you can't back away from that.
And the Arcasa board has talked about fundraising.
I know.
To sustain it, so.
Are there any foundations that can tap? Or?
Oh, yeah, there's probably lots of stuff in there.
But the point is,
it takes a lot of time and effort to get to
the yeah. point is, as a board of selectmen, we've got an obligation yeah. around the mission of Arcasa, in my opinion.
What else, like Arcasa, is funded by grants today and comes to an end? What else is like that?
We have some money in dispatch that comes from reverse 911 that's technically not guaranteed, but it's worked out well, $50,000 a year.
Mm.
That's
yeah.
about all. Schools have more.
Are we on any sliding scale things where they'll pay 75% the
no.
first year, 50, and then 25?
No, we've tried to stay away from that.
Yeah, those
generally.
Are dangerous.
Yeah. We have applied for, to hire 4 firefighters on that kind of basis yeah. where you have a decreasing support. We don't have anything currently, though. The budget you'll see next winter is not a lot different than the budget you've seen for the last few years. There's going to be some tough choices.
Now, in terms of timetable, it does not look like we're talking about any kind of an override for FY17 at this point. Is that correct?
I don't see any possibility of, I mean, if you're going to stick to posted elections, you're talking March 1st, there's
yeah.
no way.
Right.
Yeah.
You might get 5 votes, maybe
right.
6.
yeah.
No, but, you know, to have an aggressive dialogue
the
in
dialogue,
the community
yeah.
starting tonight
is not
a bad thing.
Not at all.
I'm not saying it isn't. I'm just
saying
our target is not FY17.
Yeah, I don't see any reason you can't bring a ballot question within the next year, but just not in March.
Right.
Well, I mean, one of the things to consider is it would be better to know if, as you go forward with budgets, you know, on the, you know, during the budget process, whether or not you've got money to work with or not money to work with. The idea that if something passes, I'm doing this, and if it doesn't pass, I'm doing that.
You need a contingency plan.
Yeah. I mean, I think what we need to do is try to aggressively create a discussion in our town among, you know, other boards and commissions, with FinCom, and kind of gauge people's appetite for what do they want ready to be.
There's a whole communication program that you got to put together. The survey is part of it. You got to be you have a sense of urgency that starts well ahead of whenever the election is. You know, can't wait till this time in the cycle. You got to be doing this a year.
I'm glad that we're having this discussion tonight.
There's a lot more shoes that have got to fall, and people have got to figure out what they want to do, and they're going to support or not.
Is the school committee going to come in with a similar level of thinking at the financial forum? Or?
Don't know.
I mean, they've had their unfunded kinds of things,
right.
And they've actually made some cuts in so they would probably want to get back, and maybe even given the results of the RCASA survey and things that they maybe didn't think about.
Right.
You know, like
things that they took away,
right? Like the health officer at the middle school.
That's huge.
Right. Right. That's that, like, you know,
that created
that
a big
by
crackers.
Itself, and it was a big flap over there.
There was,
and and you know, I mean, that's where you're going to need it probably more than the high school. I think it's.
It's already. I 70,
agree with that.
It's already 70% of the budget, up from 65 10 years ago.
What's that?
Schools.
You just cut it down with the facilities movement.
Okay,
but that was a positive move. No, I mean, that was smoke and mirrors, but that's a positive move.
Yeah.
Because it created efficiencies and just spread the money out.
If you look
created efficiencies.
If you look at FTEs, there's more school-related FTEs now than 25 years ago.
Sure. Even 10 years ago. Even.
And a lot less on the town side. I mean, just like...
especially certain departments.
You can get bigger
like
trucks,
work.
You can't get bigger teachers, right?
Yeah.
Well,
it's an interesting
idea. Technology and equipment really can help you in many ways. And it can help you in the classroom, but not completely.
Yeah.
You still need teachers to teach. So.
Right. So I think that, you know, this discussion tonight might change our plan for next week a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of take a step back and look at a bigger picture instead of just the next couple of years.
Will you have some scenarios worked out about how the different options under classification can help certain income groups?
Yes, just this morning we found that you're a go for November 3rd or whatever date it is. So Victor is going to send you material at least a week in advance on tax classification.
So what will he actually send us? Is it data about sort of...
What if scenarios, if you vote this, you know, it's a scale. If you do this, if you do that, and then lots of sort of information. And then surveys of peer communities. Generally, he looks at three different sets of peer communities. Some you wouldn't recognize, except that they're 90% residential like we are, but otherwise they're not near us.
Does it break it down to like things like size and scope of, you know, rather than just looking at all everything across the board from a business
size,
standpoint?
Do you mean population?
No, more like commercial.
Only by percent. So 30% commercial, 10% commercial, yes.
Well, that's one of the four votes, the residential factor, the allocation between. Then there's another one.
There's
regarding,
four.
You can exempt a certain percent of
you can exempt,
income of real estate from what?
Yeah.
An override?
From just taxes.
Taxes.
You just shift. You shift the burden.
But you'll be
to
shifting
higher
it
property
to higher property.
Yeah, but based on, it's not, that's on the class of property, not.
Is that means tested or not?
I don't want to answer that. No.
Okay.
It's asset value.
Just asset value. So
these are all shifts, so they're not adds.
Yes, correct.
Right. I mean, the pie's not growing.
But they would have a rough correlation with income. You know, the lower the property value, the bigger the impact of excluding, the more beneficial excluding the first 100K or so.
Dan, do you see yourself making any remarks at town meeting to either introduce or broach? Or I'm not talking about a full-throated introduction, but at least... to the point of getting some urgency or getting the dialogue kicked up. Do you see you're using this next town meeting?
Bob and I can talk about that. We kind of got the ball rolling last year. I don't want to put them to sleep with too many reports.
Yeah, you know,
I think it's a 10-minute, no more.
10-minute?
That comes out of the financial forum, how to use town meeting as a launching pad for that. And
well, it's good to stay in touch. I mean, I kind of started the ball, so maybe we talk a little bit about the next steps.
Okay.
Yeah. Let's collaborate. Yeah,
early and often.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'll close kind of with a remark that, you know, obviously we work with planning a lot and look at new growth, and that's all great. The finance of new growth is not that great.
Yeah.
You're not going to grow yourself out of a problem.
No. This at best will ameliorate the need.
You know, you might grab another $1 or $2 million of revenue, which is awesome. Yeah. Look at the long-term numbers. Health insurance goes up $1.5 million 1 year. Guess what? There goes your $1 or $2 million you've been working on for 10 years. You know,
exactly.
For economic development. So
alternate side of the street.
Reading is what it is. It's we're landlocked. We don't have a lot of empty land.
No.
You know, the fundamental problem of having 90-10 and Prop 2.5 is not going away.
But some of those MAPC scenarios clearly envision pretty large-scale redevelopment of 1- and 2-story buildings
in
certain areas of the town there.
And every little bit helps, so I don't mean to be discouraging, but it's not going to suddenly create $25 million new product.
Well, it's not an implementation plan. I mean, you've got to have a developer assemble that property.
Right, and when you have 4 or 5 new restaurants, well, then, you know, you got your penny on the cup of coffee on the meals tax. You've got
2.5 cents.
You know, it's, I mean, it's all...
Yeah, it does all add up, but, you know, Dan and I this morning talked to a developer. I talked to another one yesterday, and, you know, there's some really good ideas out there, but, and again, that will all help, and they will all take a great deal of work, but they will not solve any of the big problems you're looking at. You know, the landfill didn't solve any problems. It helped.
Yeah.
It was a huge help.
Maybe that's why we went 14 years.
It doesn't change the slope of the line of income and revenue. It bumps up the revenue line, but eventually you just move the intersection up.
Well, you have a revenue system that is designed to shatter.
Well, I use different words.
It forces the dialogue.
Right. Basically, you're allowed to hit the reset button, but painfully.
You might pick a different analog.
Unless you're commercial rich.
Yeah, that's what it means.
No business would run this way.
In the corporate world, we seek merger or takeover.
Yes, exactly.
Can you imagine the panic in Plymouth right now over what that's going to mean if they decommission the building?
Oh, geez. All right. So this has been helpful for Sharon and I for next week. We'll broaden that discussion a bit.
When is that?
Wednesday
7:30.
Yes.
Yep.
Senior Center. Yeah.
That's the FinCom.
Wednesday
at 7:30.
Can we ask our assessor person to look at override scenarios too? Like if we had a 2.5% override, 5, and we had that low value exclusion, how would that drop the taxes on an average house in that category?
Okay,
that would be helpful.
They used to do that every year, and they may have stopped because it was just never discussed.
I don't think they ever did in the sense of an override.
True.
Yeah,
it's just given today's taxes, here's a shift.
Yeah. No, we need the override on top of that.
Okay.
You know, those same increments we use, 2.5, 5, 7.5, 10.
Yeah, and the other, the eye-opening moment for me, similar to what John said, was when I looked at the chart that the Globe produced a couple of years ago, plotting assessed value against property taxes. Real simple concept.
Mm-hmm.
My home is worth $500,000, I'd pay $6,000 in taxes. And then you look at all of north of Boston, and Reading is fairly well below the regression line for property taxes, which is shocking.
Right.
As you ask most people in the town, oh yeah, taxes are way too high. Well, maybe they are way too high, but they're below average.
Yeah.
So, and then you're in your...
And by the way, all those communities up there are the ones that I want to compare myself
to. Right. And they're much more expensive to pay taxes.
That's really the message. Look how well, look at the efficiency of our government. Right. We're getting more for less.
It's true. So, you know, I agree with you that it has to be a couple of pretty basic, simple messages that are easy to understand and move on.
I'd like to help with that, Bob.
Yeah.
I'd like to help with the message creation and the delivery. Okay. I mean,
happy to have your help, John.
I mean, I'll take all inputs, but it seems to me the delivery of this is key if it's going to last.
Yes, sure.
I don't want it to be broken down into the usual sides that get taken and screaming and yelling. It gets nothing out. Some of that we won't be able to avoid, but
there are certain people that will be fundamentally against anything like this.
And we can probably name them.
And there are certain people who fundamentally think that you could never spend enough. I mean, you know, you've got outliers.
Some of the opponents will be out of philosophy. Some will be out of sheer financial panic and what it means to them.
Mm-hmm. Which makes it incumbent on us to turn over every rock, every opportunity to protect those people who are going to be in a jeopardous position.
A vulnerable position for them. Yeah.
You know, I mean.
Got it.
Yep.
Anything else, Mr. Chair?
I think, we don't have any minutes this time.
There are no minutes.
Well, thanks for a good meeting. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Move that the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at 9:40 p.m.
Second for Mr. Arena. All in favor? 5-0. We stand adjourned.
Are we in the air, by any chance?
Yes. Sure. Yeah. Well, we